is a Buffalo Bill?
It puts the lotion in the basket.
On the next Oprah, you'll be shocked. You'll be amazed. You'll be talking about it for the next however long until she shocks you again. Oprah makes your wildest dreams come true. Today, everyone in the studio audience, all 276 members, get a brand new liver.
Everybody gets a liver! Everybody gets a liver!
Then, tomorrow, all 276 studio audience members get a brand new uvula. The next day, all 276 members of the studio audience get a 3-foot helper monkey.
Everybody gets a 3-foot helper monkey. Everybody gets a 3-foot helper monkey.
The next day, all 276 audience members get a new prosthetic arm.
Everybody gets a prosthetic arm. Everybody gets a prosthetic arm.
Oprah, giving away great stuff she didn't have to pay for, even though she could easily afford to. And next season, everybody in the studio audience gets Stedman.
Everybody gets Stedman! Everybody gets Stedman!
Shut up! 10:51 at 560 WQM. Better late than never, that's what we say on this show.
Oh!
Yeah, and we like it.
But what?
George did a great job last week, even though I didn't hear 1 minute of it. I'm confident of it.
That was
I saw a spectacular response on our website. Even though the management doesn't like you, they hate you like poison.
Oh, I know.
And our feeling, well, as they say in the Mutual Broadcasting Network. Anyway, let's see, the poll that you took on Friday over the weekend. And let's quit picking on Dick Cheney's daughter, by the way. You talk about the media being crazy.
Who's picking? I'm grinning.
Oh, it's so sad. It is so sad the way the media just joins right in there, goose-stepping along. I think the whole media is owned by Sinclair Broadcasting, if you ask me. But anyway, here's the poll George took. What's your take on his Bill O'Reilly business on the phone sex accusations alleged? 1,769 votes. Now, you left off the one choice that I always like to put in there.
Right.
I don't give a schmidt, because that would have been my first immediate choice. I couldn't give a flying crap about Bill O'Reilly. Now, when you look at his radio ratings in the South Florida market, which he's been on there for like about a year and a half, he's going to crush Rush, baby. Even after the big Rush fallout with his little pill-popping crap. And, you know, Rush took a little bit of a hit, but O'Reilly's still got a 0.2 or something like that. He might as well not even be on the air. On the radio.
Well,
he's strictly a TV kind of a spin guy. Anyway, 1,769 votes. Both of the above, 817, meaning O'Reilly's a pervert, 771, and Macris is an extortionist, 181, and both of the above. So, in other words, he's a pervert, and she wants to get money out of it because of it, and both of the above, and I still don't give a crap. I couldn't care less about Bill O'Reilly. Small potatoes. Another man-made creation out of the media. Media invented the thing. He ain't nothing. Here's something that is something. She's on our website today on NeilRogers.com. Behind the beaded curtain if you got lots of ID or else. Frederique Vanderwall. Who? Well, she's a model and actress. She's a supermodel and super,
yeah.
Well, not so super actress. Born August 30th, 1967. I bet you have no idea where she was born.
Germany.
Vanderwall.
Oh, she's Deutsch. Dutch,
born August 30th, 1967, which makes her 37 years old in The Hague, Netherlands, in Holland, baby. Here's her filmography, short as it is. Ultimate Holiday Town, USA, made for TV. The Million Dollar Hotel, The Venice Project, The Wild Wild West. Celebrity, 54, Two Girls and a Guy, and Bernsey's Last Call. That's it. Oh, and also Marmalade and Celebrity Mole Hawaii and a bunch of pretty sad crap. But she's a fine-looking creature. And there she is. That's our creature feature on Behind the Beaded Curtain today. Take a puke at it. Here's our poll today. Well, this is really great. It's almost the end of the first hour. I forgot about this.
Oh!
I haven't been on vacation. Oh, don't go to Montreal unless you like the city, just to stay away from the people. Went there last weekend. Man, I still love that city. It's very European. Restaurants are phenomenal, but the people are strictly frogs, man. They're disgusting. They're rude. They're everything that you hate about the French. That's them. Pushy, rude, obnoxious, disgusting, nasty. They absolutely refuse to speak English.
Yeah, how'd they smell?
Absolutely.
Oh, I didn't get close enough.
Didn't whiff anybody?
What well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? That's our poll question today on NeilRogers.com. We got two to start. Rush Limbaugh.
I'm dying over here.
Pop a couple of more. Or Bill O'Reilly, the alleged telephone sex pervert. That's the start. The world's biggest phony. I got one I should add on there right away. In fact, I got two. Ann Coulter. Oh, I got several. Ann Coulter, you writing these down now?
Yes, we are.
Miss Matt Drudge.
Oh.
Miss Matt Drudge.
What's funny about him?
I don't know. Ask Little Miss Muffet. The Pope.
Ooh.
See what a good list this is going to be?
Woo.
The audience will add many, many more, I'm sure. All the phonies all the time. And who was the other one I was going to put on there? Well, I'll leave it up to them. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. Here's that schedule today. Mad Dog at 2.
All right.
The Humper at 4.
Hey, stupid.
Then you got Geldy at 7, who, of course, Jim Sarney. We'll get to that eventually. Jim Sarney had some interesting things to write about Geldy.
Ow!
He'll be at Smoky Bones tonight, 7 to 10. Eddie K at 10 o'clock.
The Howard Stern Show. Neil Rogers, mornings and midday. And sports around the clock. 560 QAM.
Desperate for changing, I went online. I emailed a dominatrix. Now everything is fine. I'm naked in a dungeon made for slaves. I get whipped when I have misbehaved. Just to prove that she is my master, I'm hanging by my testicles for her. Stiletto heels are painful when they're up my butt, but that pain isn't nothing when you're hanging from your nuts. And I've been hanging from my testicles for days. Now my bones are rotted and decayed. Just to prove that she is my master, I'm hanging by my testicles for her. My scrotum used to be a normal sack. Now I can pull it halfway up my back. All to prove that she is my master, I'm hanging by my testicles for her.
Rectum.
I'd love to hear them play that on the Bill O'Reilly Show tonight, if I watch, which I don't. Wouldn't that be a great theme song for Bill? 27 votes on the poll already.
Vibration.
What well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? Rush Limbaugh, 15. Bill O'Reilly, 5. Matt Drudge, he's got 3. Now, how come it doesn't say Miss Matt Drudge on there, like I said?
Yeah, we'll have to fix that. Commie plot.
Well, what? No, seriously, did I make it very clear? I said, be sure we put that on there, Miss Matt Drudge, so we know which Drudge we're talking about, the Drudge Meister.
Josh, God. I thought you were Josh.
The Pope 3 and Ann Coulter's only got 1, but you ought to see it's a very impressive one is what I'm hearing. Oh, speaking of that, now a couple of these stories we had on the website during the week, and I don't know if you dealt with them or not, but that's okay.
Okay.
Because I'll deal with them anyway.
Okay.
What about, did you do the one from Spring Hill, Tennessee, woman accused of selling vibrator disguised as duck?
No.
Oh. Catherine Williams says the yellow ducky sponge she put on sale at a flea market is merely a child's toy. City officials say the vibrator inside makes it a sex toy. But officials in this Nashville suburb backed off from citing Williams for violating the city's sexually oriented business ordinance because she'd already taken down her display by the time police responded to a complaint Saturday. Nearby vendors also refused to be witnesses in the case. We've declined to prosecute because of a lack of evidence, City Administrator Ken York said last week. Williams, whose passions and pleasures business sells lotions and adult novelties at in-home parties, described her product line as PG-13 and said she only got 2 negative comments at the flea market. Nothing we do is nasty unless you have a nasty mind, she said, turning a knob on the... next thing they're going to outlaw selling cucumbers in Publix. Just when the hell does it stop? Right?
Anything that's longer than it is wide.
Right. Salami, sausages, forget about that. Bratwurst, forget about it.
They're the worst.
Anyway, she says, nothing we do is nasty unless you have a nasty mind, turning a knob on the yellow ducky's tail to make the sponge vibrate. My 3-year-old son loves to play with his duck in the bath. He put it on his neck and on his head. William said she'll be back at the flea market next year. If she does, she'll be cited in court. You're into court, York said. That duck is a sex toy, and it was on display. That was a vibrator on display in public view.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Well, you know how dangerous they are.
Zion America, and you wonder why Bush is a little bit ahead in the polls or whatever. Are they going to steal the election in 2 weeks?
Hey, you can put an eye out with one of those.
Don't forget early voting today, by the way, in Florida. Get out there and vote a whole bunch of times.
About 30, man.
For Kerry. And all you Nader people, let me just tell you right now, if you even think about voting for Ralph Nader. Yeah, we don't want to make any threats to the Nader voters, but you know, just keep that in mind. Katrina Vandenhoevel sums it up very well about the Cheneys, Lynn and Dick. She says, have you noticed that when Lynn Cheney thunders about being an indignant mother, she can't repress a smile? And when husband Dick says he's an angry father, he's smirking? That's because they're actually far more pleased than outraged by John Kerry's mention of their daughter's sexual orientation in the last debate. Now they have an issue to distract the country from George Bush's awful debate performances, and the media, which drank deeply from Cheney's WMD concoction, has once again swallowed his deceptions hook, line, and sinker. It was Dick Cheney himself who first brought up his daughter's lesbianism in the 2000 vice presidential debate when he wanted to burnish his compassionate side, a quality never noticed much before and completely absent since. When John Edwards mentioned Cheney's daughter in this year's VP debate, Cheney thanked him for his kind words. But within moments after the third debate between Bush and Kerry, Lynn Cheney was already with a canned line of fake indignation to feed the post-debate news shows, and now it's morphed into an applause line in both Mom and Pop's campaign speeches. This isn't parental outrage, it's political theater from two of the most cynical people in American politics, and they've successfully manipulated the mainstream media once again, Katrina writes. She was on one of the shows this weekend. She's great, Katrina Vandenhoevel.
Mm-hmm.
Not just in print, but she can also speak, too. She's great. We love Katrina at The Nation. Don't we? Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
Just thought I'd mention that. Okay, we'll get some other things for the poll here, I'm assuming. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. What well-known person do you think is the biggest phony is our poll question today. QAM, hello. Hello. I just want to make sure that there was nobody there. Maybe they're off to a slow start this week, too. Or maybe Duff came into their breakfast table this morning as they were sitting down at the breakfast table ready to enjoy a delicious breakfast with a smile on her face and turn that smile into a frown. Little Miss Muffet, the messenger lady.
Turn the smile upside down.
Yeah, the audience should know this. I'm on vacation last week. George does his usual sensational job. I come back this morning. I'm in a great mood. I'm relaxed. I've had a few days off. And I sit down here at 20 past 8 in this chair. 8:21, who marches into the studio? Little Miss Muffet, Muff Lindsay, our former program director turned operations manager turned dump button monkey. The dump button lady. And says to George, what was the exact words?
Could you excuse us for a minute?
Excuse us for a minute. And now he goes into a thing about Greg Reed and my lawyer Norma Kent and this and that and this one having a temper tantrum. Stuff that has nothing to do with me, really, directly. And I'd like the hell with all of them, you know what I'm saying? Get out of my face. Don't bug me anymore. Duff, go away, messenger lady. Within 60 seconds or less, I think it was more like
about 30, man.
My fat, pimply ass sitting in his chair. Here comes the muff lady. Oh, well, Greg wanted me to call you on Friday, but you were on vacation. Just go away, okay? You're all a bunch of crazy people. Leave me alone. WQAM, happy Monday, hello.
Kathy Lee Gifford.
Excellent choice, I love it.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Wasn't that a good one?
That was great.
In fact, that inspired me to play a whole bunch of good stuff. Let's see, now we can't play that one.
No.
Oh, I know, wait a minute. Now, what's the one where she's they're selling Kathy Lee's crap, the slave labor, the sweatshops? Oh, they are. It's called They Are the Kids.
They are the kids. Right.
That's what it's called. What a mind. What a memory, man.
There is a child living down in Mexico who has to go to work every day.
I'm dying out of here.
Sits at his desk making clothes for Kathy Lee. Loves the work, but doesn't love the pay. They are the kids who make the clothing. They are the ones who make a buck a day, so quit complaining.
8 bucks.
It's just clothes they're making. The kind you love to buy. It's true they make a buck a day with Kathy Lee.
You bitch. You slut, you whore.
Well said. Excellent choice to start. WQAM, hello.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, here you go. Mel Martinez and the late Pat Paulson.
WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to vote for... I'm just heading right now to the polls.
Okay.
And I have two. Can I have two for your poll?
Go right ahead. Well, wait a minute. First of all, who are you voting for?
Well, you know... Che Guevara. No, wait a minute. No, I'm voting for Kerry.
Okay. Why did you just say it? I mean, you don't have to be ashamed. They are tracing the call. They will come knock on your door at 3 o'clock tonight, men from the governor's office. Anyway, go ahead. What do you got?
Mary Cheney.
Yeah.
And Jimmy Swagger.
Who?
Jimmy Swagger.
Oh, Jimmy Lee Swagger. Okay, two good choices again. Thank you. This poll could be like a zillion, Ooh. Couldn't it? All the phonies all the time, maybe. So many phonies in so little time. So many egos in so little time. So many overgrown little children masquerading as adults in so little time. You know who I'm talking about? I'm sure you do,
no.
George.
Who?
This, I'm telling you, this radio station is a killer. You people are, you are tuned in right now to the killer, to killer radio. Not necessarily in a positive sense, like killer, like we're killing them, but killer as in it'll kill all of us before we're done. Man, it is just absolutely unacceptable is what it is. Muff, stay out of my face. Don't be giving me any more messages. Go away, okay, you neurotic, crazy bastards, you, the whole bunch of you. See, I've got 2 years to go, and believe you me, that is the end. This is the end, boys and girls. And I will say, during that 2 years and a couple of months, whatever it is, I have no need, no reason to be in contact with Muff Lindsay, with Clarence, whatever her name is, with any of these crazy people, with a water Nazi. I don't need to be there. That's one of the reasons I'm so glad not to be there, is I don't have to encounter those neurotic people face to face. The last time I was down there, which you'll recall, every day was another crisis. Every day another hush, closed door, well, ba-da-beep, ba-da-boop, ba-da-boop, you know, all peeing in each other's pants, which I'm, quite frankly, got a few questions about that. I think they have a word for that. But at any rate, and I just, I don't want to be part of any of that stuff. I'm here to do the show, that take the check, that's it. Just send me the money and go away. Leave me alone. 12 minutes after 11 at 560 WQAM, IRS tax problems have a way of ruining all aspects of your life, just like the people at QAM do. They take a toll on you financially, physically, and emotionally. You can never really forget about your IRS problems as they come back each morning when you wake up, like a nightmare. CPA Jamie Buchwald and the Buchwald Tax Firm can help you end your IRS problems forever and give you back peace of mind. That's why other top CPA and law firms referred their clients to the Buchwald Tax Firm when they got IRS problems. Why not avoid potential criminal prosecution? Get all your unfiled tax returns prepared, even if you lost all your records. Suppose you have an IRS lien, wage levy, owe payroll taxes and penalties, want to settle for thousands less than you owe, need time to pay, whatever it might be, the Buchwald Tax Firm can help you out. They offer a free initial consultation, affordable and guaranteed fees, and immediate relief from IRS harassment, or is that harassment? And best of all, you never have to meet with the IRS either. The Buchwald Tax Firm handles all meetings and discussions, so you don't have to. Call 954-575-2800. That's 954-575-2800. Whether you owe $10,000 or $1 million in IRS taxes or somewhere in between, the Buchwald Tax Firm can help you out. Call 954-575-2800 today for your free consultation or check them on the web at www.irsfreedom.com. That's irsfreedom.com. And stop worrying about the IRS knocking at your front door.
You are listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
Fiedler is dumb and Dave Wannstedt is dumb founded.
Ladies, if you're out of work, why not lift yourself up and join the Jimmy Swaggart Ministry? Right now, there are numerous openings you can fill by assuming a missionary position with Jimmy Swaggart. Transportation is provided. Jimmy will drive you around personally. You'll not only get hands-on experience, you'll get hands-all-over-you experience. Assume the missionary position right now, and you'll work directly under Jimmy Swaggart. After all, you already have something in common with Jimmy. You want a job, and he wants a job. Bless you.
I'm looking at that poll. Look at the way that Josh spelled Jimmy Swaggart. You know, Josh is a good guy, but he's got the brain the size of a...
See him.
Yeah.
He doesn't know from evangelistic...
Swaggart, right? Swaggart, Swaggart, S-W-A-G-G-E-R-T, L-M-S-N-O-P, and et cetera. God. And I don't think that caller meant Mary Cheney. I think he meant Lynn Cheney. Wouldn't you?
That's
What's
what
phony
said.
About Mary Cheney, huh?
I don't know. I think they meant Lynn Cheney.
Yeah, I think they meant Lynn. But at any rate, we'll just put a whole bunch of names on there. How many? 1,000?
About 30,
30,000 names on there to give you something to do today. After you finish voting for Kerry several times. 5670560. By the way, don't get sucked into the... Oh, look who's on there.
Careful. Speaking of sucking. Is that where you think this election is going to be decided?
Oh, and what a match made in hell, man. Tommy Fiedler and Ricky Ticky Sanchez.
There are a few other counties in there.
There's a few other counties. By the way, the Herald endorsed Kerry. We'll get to that, all those endorsements. And the Tampa Tribune didn't endorse anybody. They said a pox on both of them. Kind of my feeling about, like, Greg Reed and Norm Kent. To hell with both of them. Presidential race tightens up again. Democratic challenger John Kerry cut President Bush's lead to 2 points. How can this man be ahead? How can this doddering imbecile be ahead? What kind of a morons are we dealing with, Americans or what?
Yeah.
Oh, that's it. My God, he comes across a simpleton. In three debates, he gets walloped. But you got to hand it to Karl Rove and those Nazis, man. They know how to change the subject. First, they did it with that Swiftboat Veterans crap. That was magnificent. Because all of the issues, I mean, it's a disaster. The economy's a disaster. What's happening in Iraq is a disaster. The environment's a disaster. Jobs, people out of work. You name it. No matter what this man has touched, it's a disaster. He's like the Greg Reed of politics. And yet, he's up a couple of points in the polls. But don't get sucked in by that CNN thing. That's Gallup again. And Gallup interviews like 38%. And I'm not making this up. 38% Republicans, 31% Democrats. So guess what? Bush is a few points ahead now, they say. Don't forget about them. CNN, they are the Antichrist, okay? Each and every one of those people at CNN ought to be like nailed to a cross and crucified. Every one of them. Except Candy Crowley. She'd bring the cross down. Can you imagine that? They'd have to bury that thing 20, 30 feet deep in the ground.
About 30, man.
Anyway, Kerry cut Bush's lead to 2 points with the just over 2 weeks to go, according to the Reuters Zogby poll released yesterday. This is the latest poll that may have any significance whatsoever, although the state-by-state polls are kind of interesting, too. Like, for example, Kerry is 4 points ahead in Ohio, allegedly, and 3-4 points ahead in Wisconsin. We'll see. We'll get to it. And you see all the stuff that they're pulling out, the tearing up Democratic registrations in Oregon, things like that. Just little minor things. Not that they play dirty tricks, you understand.
Commie lies.
Bush led Kerry 46-44% in the latest 3-day tracking poll of the closely contested race. The president had led him 48-44% the previous day. The third debate is now registering among voters, and Kerry had a good day, John Zogby said. The new tracking poll found Kerry regained a good lead among 18 to 29-year-old voters.
Oh!
Oh, thank God there's hope for the young people in America. Thank the Lord. We've got some brains and consolidated his advantage among Hispanics. And, of course, we're not talking so much about South Florida Hispanics because that's a horse of another color, another flavor. Bush and Kerry were tied among Roman Catholics, a group Kerry himself, a Catholic, must win to capture the White House, Zogby said. And the Pope says,
Humdred.
Among the 7% of voters still undecided, Bush had a 34% positive job rating versus a 66% negative rating. This is among the undecideds. Only 18% of undecided respondents said the president deserved re-election, while 39% said it was time for somebody new. In the latter group, 99% said they were likely to vote. So where does all this other CNN Gallup crap come from? USA Today? Tomorrow? Pulling out of their ass is what I'm thinking. Because it's part of this bandwagon mentality. Oh, look at this. Bush is ahead. The people must know something you don't know. We better vote for him. While all the people are lined up for their flu shots. How come Kerry let so many holes, they opened up enough holes for him. Mm-hmm. He could have driven a fleet of Mack trucks through it in that third debate. This business about, well, we don't have enough flu vaccines, so now we got people 90 years old standing in line for hours in the sweltering heat in California and in wherever the hell it is.
Mm-hmm.
Waiting for a chance, not just waiting for a shot, but for a chance to get ripped off for a flu shot. And he says, well, we can get him from our Canadian friends to the north, our Canadian. Yeah, these are the same Canadians who buy, and I noticed in his speech the next day, Kerry finally brought it up because somebody wrote it for him. The same Canadians where it was the 10th world of drugs that we're getting, and we don't dare let the Americans import their drugs from Canada. And let me tell you right now, by the way, the people up here are pretty unhappy about the whole idea of letting Americans import drugs because now they're fearing a drug shortage here because the Americans are getting ripped off by the pharmaceutical companies with the help of Bush. Why didn't he pick on that one?
Diet.
A gigantic mammoth opening. And what was the other one I was going to mention that he left? I forgot. I'll get to it. Just enormous, gigantic openings. And in spite of the fact that he really blew it in a couple of ways, he still buried him. You go online a couple hours after the debate finished, and like on the MSNBC poll, it was like 71-29% Kerry won.
Right.
Even on the Fox poll, and they would never admit it, but if you went on there a couple hours after the voting started on their poll, it was like 56-44% Kerry won that poll. Even on the right-wing Fox, we twist all the news poll. We make Sinclair look like a bunch of liberals. Oh, you might be interested that some of those Sinclair stations are Fox affiliates. You might just be interested in that.
Gee, what a shock.
Yeah. But they keep changing the story, obfuscating, covering up all of the facts. That's what they, and yet on every issue, the Middle East is a nightmare. You name it. We had six more American troops die over the weekend. But forget about these things, okay? Because here's leadership you can trust. Right. Here's somebody who is articulate, makes a lot of sense. In fact, where's that one bit? One moment, please. I got to play this. Is this it?
Welcome to another hilarious episode of George Bush Theater.
They think you're like Rain Man without the mask.
George plays Rain Man.
Raymond, what were you doing in my room?
I believe...
Raymond, what were you doing in my room?
I don't know.
You don't know what you were doing in my room.
And...
There were noises. Well, those noises are none of your business. You understand that?
I understand now.
Huh? Put the phone book down. Stop acting like an idiot. Go to sleep.
Go
to sleep!
Stay tuned for the next George Bush Theater, where George plays Forrest Gump.
That's not the one. I'll find it. I'm just all whipped up to a frenzy about it, in case you haven't noticed.
No, that's all right.
Well, you know, I've been off for a few days. I've got all this pent up. Plus, that episode with Muff Lindsay this morning, totally, absolutely unacceptable. Stay the hell away from this kid, okay, sweetheart? You silly child, you. 567-0560-#560 on the AT&T and Verizon line. Well, what one person do you think is the biggest phony? We got Rush Limbaugh. Oh, look at that. 67 votes for the pill popper. How's Wilma doing? Out of 117, he's got over half of the votes. Bill O'Reilly, 24, pervert. The Pope's got 7, altar boys. Ann Coulter, 6. Miss Matt Drudge, he's got 6. Kathy Lee Gifford, 4. Lynn Cheney's got a pair. And Jimmy Swaggart's got 1. WQAM, hello.
117, he's on.
QAM, yeah. Yes, sir.
Hey, how you doing?
All right.
A question for you. Is that the pound 560 line, is that free?
Yeah.
Okay, great. For the poll...
Yeah.
Nancy Grace.
Oh, I love that. Thank you. That's beautiful. Okay, that's an excellent choice, even from that nut job. She makes me barf. Oh, God. She's always got that sneer on her face and that phony southern drawl.
Oh. She's so affected.
Yeah. Man, oh, man, I'd like to take my foot and stick it where the moon don't shine. Watch my toe come out the top of her head. 567-0560. Boy, am I whipped up now or what?
No, it's great.
And I was so mellow before 8:21 this morning. Before
you
that unacceptable. If the audience could only have, I should have had the tape rolling, you know. Next time I'm going to, well, there won't be any next time. Because the next time that happens, I'm getting up and I'm going in the other room and making some bacon. I'm just getting out of here. Seriously, I won't tolerate that kind of like negative kind of like right before you're going to go on the air after a nice week vacation and like, let us crap on you. Let us just destroy your day. Let us put you into as negative a possible frame of mind as we can. And this is a way of saying thank you for 7 years of magnificent service and screw you, you know, well, back at you.
Have a good show.
Yeah. WQAM, hello.
Good morning.
Yes, sir. Buenos dias.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
National polls are a real waste of time because obviously everybody knows, unless they haven't checked lately, we don't vote as a nation. We vote state
correct.
By state. So
right.
National polls are a magnificent waste of time, and they're used to justify somehow the contracts run by CNN, USA Today, Gallup, whoever else is in.
Right.
The only polls to pay attention to
state.
Are the Zogby state-by-state polls.
Right.
And those polls are pretty close, all within the margin of error. The other thing is that if you remember, if you really want to pay attention to national polls, 4 years ago, if you go back, and George could probably Google this, Bush was up between, 6 and 11 points going into Election Day on Al Gore, depending on which poll you looked at. And we all know what happened then.
Well, the last day before the election was 48-45. Bush was 3 points ahead.
That was the consensus, but there were others that were higher, and others which were actually having a dead heat.
So and Gore won the about half a million votes.
Half a million votes, exactly. That we know of.
Won the election.
That we know of, because remember, the votes never got fully counted.
That's correct.
So. from that aspect, it's not a big deal. It's just one of these things that these guys have nothing better to talk about, and so they go back and forth and back and
forth. Well, no, it's not just that, but it's their way of spinning it and trying to, like, you know, get that bandwagon effect going because they want to be good goose-stepping, obedient Nazis.
Well, that's true. They're not – actually, you know, I'll disagree with you on this. They're not – they don't have an agenda. They're lazy. It's not that they have an agenda. They are lazy.
You see what's happening with the media today. They do have an agenda.
Well, some do. I mean, obviously Fox and those people, they're off the charts. But I'm saying
CNN has become Fox Lite.
Right, to a degree. But, I mean, there are some people who are just lazy and they want stuff handed. Look who are your national correspondents are. They're lightweights. I wouldn't buy the weather from them. If they sat there and told me these things.
Okay, got to run, Pally. Good point. Thank you. Plus, I like that echo. 28 past 11 at 560 WQM with all the hurricane mess in September. Armstrong, Florida Homestead's got to clear out all remaining 04s to make room for the 2005s. And you're going to save like never before on all remaining 04s in stock, ready for immediate delivery, if not sooner. Choose from Ranger, Tundra, and F-150 pickups, Explorers and Expeditions, Crown Vicks, Tauruses, Focuses, and Mustangs, too. Every 04 on the lot at Armstrong Ford Homestead has been drastically reduced, and you'll save thousands, literally. Plus, Armstrong Ford offers more value to its loyal customers. When you buy your Ford from Armstrong Ford, you'll get their exclusive Tires and Batteries for Life program. That is correct. Tires and Batteries for Life. The value you'll get at Armstrong Ford goes on, because right now they'll give you a free Florida Sun Pass with any vehicle you buy. If you've been wanting a new car, but you've been putting it off, wait no more. David Rich and the staff at Armstrong Ford Homestead will guarantee you the best price. And don't forget, Armstrong Ford Homestead is locally owned and operated. They treat you great, like family, and you won't get a better deal anywhere in South Florida than at Armstrong Ford. No bait and switch, no phony deals. Armstrong Ford Homestead, you'll find them at 30725 South Dixie Highway, just 20 minutes south of the 836, well worth the drive. Check them on the web at armstrongcars.com. Drive a little and save thousands on that new Ford only at Armstrong Ford of Homestead.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM. Republican Palooza.
We know. We don't know.
Don't know why I didn't come.
We do not know. We don't know.
George Bush.
Talking about my generation.
We don't get fooled again.
If fooled, we can't get fooled again.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
It's not easy.
To be me.
Republican Palooza. Get your tickets now.
It's not easy.
There's no two ways about it. It's not easy.
To be me.
It's not easy.
It was the most difficult decision that I've made in my entire life. I decided to get a bikini wax.
And don't forget, it's hard work. It's hard work.
It's hard work.
27 on noon. That's a great clip we got there on neilrogers.com. In fact, we got all kinds of good stuff. I love that ad we got on there. And even better than that ad with the broad sitting on the bench, I love the new ads from MoveOn.org and the Democratic National Committee where they're just, it's a beautiful thing. You got
to
see it.
You don't have to say anything. Just show the man.
Oh, man. Just amazing. Wow. Well, but that's, and when you look, speaking of this, last guy had a good point. You look at the, for example, on USA Today, if you go to their website, even though it is the Gallup thing again, and they have the state by state. As of the, they've updated it as of this morning. It's pretty good. And they got the state by state polls.
Mm-hmm.
And just take a look at the states that are in red. There are a few that are like in light orange that are undecided, too close to callers, including Florida. But take a look at that. Oh, look at this. Who do you think will win on the CNN Gallup Nazi poll? Bush 56 and Kerry 36. Not who you're for, but who do you think will win? Let's just keep goose-stepping that up there, all you idiots there at Fox Light. Yeah, keep goose-stepping along. For example, this morning they showed about 30 seconds of Bush speaking in West Palm Beach, and then they showed about 5 minutes, or Kerry speaking in West Palm, they showed about 5 minutes of Bush making a speech about the American Olympic athletes, as he said, the athletes. Fair and unbiased, man. That's where it's at. Anyway, Christians urge crackdown on spitting Jews. Do you have this story?
I saw it, but I did not mention it.
Well, it's important stuff, man.
Well, I don't want to be accused, you know.
Good old-time religion, baby. Right. Christian leaders in Jerusalem have attacked what they say is the increasingly common phenomenon of spitting by ultra-Orthodox Jews on members of their faith.
Oy!
Ooh, juicy.
The statement followed a brawl between an Orthodox Jewish student and an Armenian archbishop. That's right. The two men clashed in Jerusalem's Old City after a yeshiva student spat at a cross being carried by the clergyman during a procession near the Holy Sepulchre, the revered site of Jesus' crucifixion.
Jesus Christ.
Archbishop Nurhan Manugian.
Eh?
I wonder if he's related to Armin Katiyan.
Manugian.
Then slapped the yeshiva student in the ensuing scuffle. His 17th century ceremonial medallion was broken. Said I wouldn't spend on a best party if I could find it. Both were questioned by police, and the yeshiva student is facing charges. He's been banned from approaching the Old City for 75 days. It's good to see that that roadmap is working real well there in the Middle East. Things are going real well. That's another part of the world where this administration has really got their thumb on it, baby. They're doing it. The Armenians have branded the police action inadequate, say this sort of thing's been going on for years. I don't know what they're upset about. The Orthodox Jews, they spit on the other Jews, too, okay? So what are they worried about? In an interview with Israeli newspaper Monday, Archbishop Manugian demanded that Israeli leaders speak out about the abuse. When there's an attack against Jews anywhere in the world, the Israeli government is incensed, so why when our religion and pride are hurt, don't they take harsher measures, he asked, adding that officials are not interested when we're humiliated on a daily basis. Yada, 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 and a partridge in a pear tree, and our religion's better than your religion, and a chabir and beard. What was that?
I don't know. Nothing.
That was really juicy. That was beautiful. Oh, and speaking of that liberal media, more of the brainwashing of America, Democracy Radio, a group of broadcasters whose aim is to develop progressive radio programming, says that a nationwide survey of talk radio indicates that nearly 90% of all political talk radio shows in America reflect conservative views, while only 10% of talk is progressive. And, of course, that 10% would include Al Franken and what's her name?
Oh, Catherine Lamper.
Catherine Lamper, yeah. Democracy Radio conducted a nationwide survey of local and syndicated talk shows, compiled data on the hundreds of programs, hosts, and stations that currently exist on the airwaves. The data concludes that in all of talk radio, there are 3,042 hours of airtime dedicated to progressive talk, compared to the 41,731 hours of conservative talk time per week. Despite the fact that a majority of all talk radio listeners are not conservative, talk radio programs that reflect conservative viewpoints continue to dominate the airwaves, said Democracy Radio Executive Director Tom Athens. This means that only one political perspective is being broadcast on airwaves that are entirely owned by a very diverse American public. Democracy is undermined, and Americans are wronged if only one political point of view is being expressed on the air, which simply needs to change. Is it going to change?
No.
No. Does anybody care?
No.
No, nobody do nothing about it. Except, of course, for Air America with the tapes of Randy from, day before, whatever it is. That's where she is. This makes me sick to my stomach. But again, par for the course, Florida Governor Jeb Bush, your fat-ass governor, ignored advice to throw out a flawed felon list, voter list before it went out to county election offices, despite warnings from state officials, according to a published report this weekend. In a May 4th email obtained by the Sarasota Herald Tribune, Florida Department of Law Enforcement computer expert Jeff Long told his boss in the orifice that a colleague at the Department of State had told him that yesterday they recommended to the governor they pull the plug on the voter database. The email said state elections officials weren't comfortable with the felon matching program they've got, but added the governor rejected their suggestion to pull the plug, so they're going to live with it this weekend. Long, who was responsible for giving elections officials his department's felon database, confirmed the contents of the email on Friday to the Herald Tribune. He said he did not remember the specifics, but that Paul Kraft, the Department of State's top computer expert, had told him about the meeting with Bush, our fat-ass governor. A software program matched data on felons with voter registration rolls to create the list of 48,000 names. Secretary of State Glenda in the Hood junked the database in July after admitting that 2,500 ex-felons on the list had their voting rights restored. Most of them, by the way, were Democrats, and many of them were black. Here comes the real chigger in a woodpile. Hispanics, who in Florida mostly vote Republican, were almost entirely absent from the list due to a technical error. Okay?
Yeah.
Not because there was any hanky-panky going on. You want to steal it like that in broad daylight, like right out in the open. And you know what? There's a good chance they're going to do it again.
Mm-hmm.
They're working feverishly on it. But anyway, don't let me get all whipped up now. It's only Monday.
Too late.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Muff. And just stay the hell away, okay? Stay very, very, very far away. Like about 1,200 miles sounds good to me. 20 till noon at 560 WQM. You want to know more about following a low-carb diet, which everybody, I don't care what they try to tell you about, the fad is over with, forget about it. It's not a fad. More and more people are doing the low-carb thing. When you go into the supermarket now, you find a whole bunch of stuff, most of which is garbage, by the way, which is why you want to go to Delights, because they've got all kinds of really great stuff that really is low-carb. Whether you're starting or restarting the Atkins, Sugar Busters, South Beach, or any low-carb sugar-free diet, Delights of West Book has always been the smart low-carb store to shop in, the number one store in South Florida. And, of course, like I said, you can shop in a local grocery store, but forget about that because it's pretty limited. But when you're at Delights, they've got zillions, over 1,200 great low-carb products like Carbolite ice cream, breads, pasta, chocolates, brownies, cookies, and lots more. Delights is open every day, 7 days a week from 10 till 10, and the folks there who work at Delights know low-carb dieting inside and out. Delights is located on the northeast corner of Glades and 441, right next to Boston Market. Call them toll-free at 1-877-LOW-CARB, L-O-W-C-A-R-B, or on the web, it's lowcarb.com. There's only one, but what a great store it is. Delights of West Boca, your official Atkins Retail Center.
You're listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively on 560-2AM.
A lollipop, little boy?
And now, another tale from the cell phone of Dick Cheney. Today, Dick dials celebrity biographer Kitty Kelly.
Hello. Kitty Kelly, please.
Speaking.
Yes, Kitty. This is Dick Cheney, Vice President of the United States of America. How are you?
Fine.
That's good. That's nice.
Is there something I can help you with?
Yes. It's just that a book that's coming out next week that you wrote. Frankly, we question its credibility, and I was wondering if maybe you could wait a couple of months before actually putting it out.
I'm sorry, my phone is breaking up. Did you just ask me not to print the book until after the election?
Yes. After George Bush gets reelected, print all you want. We won't care then.
Why would I want to do that? Hello?
Money-grubbing a...
What?
Liar!
Oh, my...
If your book's released, the terrorists win!
Huh?
You're messing with the President of the United States of America!
Okay, I'm hanging up now.
We know where you live, you dumb bitch!
Okay.
That's right. We'll get your little dog Toto, too!
Bye-bye!
What's wrong with you? Hello? Hello?
This has been another tale from the cell phone of Dick Cheney.
14 till noon at 560. He sure is one fine upstanding, hunching over old man, ain't he?
All right, then. Those
wait till you hear this. This is going to get you really flagellating it. Computer problems reported at some early voting sites.
Oh, my God.
How do you like that? Problems were being reported at 9 of 14 early voting sites in Broward County this morning already. Okay, this is the first day of early voting in Florida, and already 9 of 14 early voting sites, they got service, baby. Gisella Salas of the Broward Elections Office said workers were having problems with a live database connection that's used to verify that a voter is properly registered. The sites, Salas said, that were unaffected were at satellite offices in Deerfield Beach. Now, wait a minute. It said the sites that were unaffected were at satellite offices in Deerfield Beach, Hollywood, Lauderhill, Pembroke Pines, and Plantation. All the branch offices reported having problems with the database connection. Many of the sites had voters lined up to cast their ballots. Voters at several sites said poll workers told them the problem started 20 to 30 minutes after the early polling stations opened, 8:30 this morning. The stations closed at 6 p.m. tonight. In Palm Beach County, the center of the madness during the 2000 presidential recount,
oy!
A state legislator said she wasn't given a complete absentee ballot when she asked not to use the electronic touchscreen machines. And in Orange County, the touchscreen system briefly crashed, paralyzed voting in Orlando and its immediate suburbs. I'm going to tell you something, baby. We've been had. State Representative Shelley Vanna, Democrat Lantana, was the seventh person in line Monday at a Palm Beach County early voting site. She said the paper absentee ballot she was given was missing one of its two pages, including the proposed amendments to the state constitution. And by the way, vote yes on Prop 4. Don't forget about that.
Yes.
She said election workers were indifferent when she pointed out the oversight. Let me read that last part again. She said the paper absentee ballot she was given was missing one of its two pages, including the proposed amendments to the state constitution. She said election workers were indifferent when she pointed out the freaking oversight. There was absolutely no concern on the part of the folks at the supervisor of elections office that this page was missing. This is not a good start.
Sonny, this would be your biggest problem.
If there are incomplete ballots out there, I can't imagine I would be the only one getting it, she said. Election Supervisor Teresa Laporte did not immediately return a call for comment. If she's smart, she's heading for the hills right now. She's in some kind of an unmarked pickup truck with her shotgun in the back and heading for the hills, Teresa, you idiot, you stupid-ass bitch. In Orange County, the computers went down for about 10 minutes shortly after the voting began, said Margaret Dunn, the senior deputy election supervisor. I think Dunn is the word. She said she didn't know what caused the problem, but speculated a faulty internet connection may have been to blame. Oh, maybe I can come on down and crawl around on the floor and get it fixed like I did for this one, while Greg was having another one of his temper tantrums. Texas, Colorado, and Arkansas also began casting early ballots today, 15 days before Election Day. Other key states this year have already begun in-person voting, including Wisconsin, Iowa, Nevada, Ohio, New Mexico, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. In Palm Beach County, a steady flow of voters cast early ballots. Robin Punches, a stay-at-home mom from West Palm Beach, said she came early to vote because she heard it would increase the chance of her vote being accurately counted. It was her first time using the touchscreen voting machines. It tells you exactly what to do. It's idiot-proof, she said. Well, that should be good for our audience then. In Dade County, where early voting sites would open later today, about 150 people gathered for a rally led by Reverend Al Sharpton and former U.S. Attorney General Janet Reno, speaking of pickup trucks. Some people were carrying homemade signs that said, early voting counts and early vote matters. Every vote matters, something like that. Rosemary Michael, 41, said you would cast your first vote in a presidential election when the early voting poll site. That's what it says here. This is the Sun Sentinel. I know that doesn't make any sense, but that's what it says. She came to the U.S. from Haiti because a U.S. citizen in 98, didn't vote in the 2000 election because she wasn't interested. Now she's knocking on doors and telling people to vote. I can't imagine who she's voting for, can you?
No, let me guess.
Every vote counts, she said. Early voting was introduced, yada, 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 dee, ba, boop, ba, ba, and it goes on about this. Across Florida, Democratic college students camped overnight at election offices to be the first in line this morning. The state's Congressional Black Caucus is traveling to five cities over 4 days. Oh, don't they understand they're not allowed to vote? To emphasize early voting and voter protection, State Representative Ann Gannon, a Delray Beach Democrat, is hosting a get-out-the-vote barbecue. Governor Fat-Ass Jeb Bush disagrees with the plan to open only one early voting place in downtown Jacksonville to cover all of Duval County, and Secretary of State Glenda in the Hood urged the county Saturday to increase accessibility to early voting, and of course they made sure that they had that one place as far away from the dark neighborhoods as they possibly could. A Jacksonville city attorney has said it's too late to open new sites, even though the city council has committed more money to the idea. With 500,000 voters, Duval is the state's most populous county with only one site. Only one location, far, far away from you dark folks up there. For voters in Palm Beach County, how do you like that? So 9 of the 14 early voting sites already are having Cirrus. Isn't that a good sign?
Yeah, lovely.
Excellent. Okay, let's get back to some of these calls. 5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless line. WQAM, hello. Back at you. WQAM, hello.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's Neil's buddy in Toronto.
Yeah.
Yeah. Neil?
This is Neil.
Hi, Neil. How are you?
You're in Toronto?
Yeah. Well, listen, Neil, what happened to you? You didn't tape
mean?
The last night's edition on CBC, The World According to Bush.
Oh, no, I forgot all about that.
Oh, boy, I figured you'd have a doozy for your audience this morning.
Don't got it.
Talk about an agenda by the Cable Nazi Network.
Mm-hmm.
No, it was quite interesting. So we missed you here. Happy that you're back on board. And George did a great job while you were away.
Yes, he did. He was sensational last week. In fact, I'm thinking he was so good last week, another shot this week would be good.
Why, you need a vacation that bad?
Yeah, after 8:21 this morning.
You're a smart man. You're down in Florida now?
No,
you're
I'm
down
not.
I'm not. Well, you're in Toronto.
Of course.
Oh, okay. You're
putting up. I want to be in Florida for with a bunch of mugwumps. Who the hell wants to be there?
Ah, there you go. Now I hear that I'm on the air. Okay, great. So, Neil, you have yourself a good day. Nice to you're back.
Okay, take it
care.
Easy, eh?
Take care.
Okay,
bye-bye.
And I'll drop a quarter in your cap. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT and the Verizon and Singular Wireless lines, like I just said. WQAM, hello. QAM? John Kerry Election Headquarters? Not there. QAM, hello.
Hey, Neil, how about Dennis Miller?
Oh, ooh. I love it.
Excellent.
There you go.
Phony's the understanding of the century.
Yeah, he switched big time. Thanks.
Okay, thanks. Bye. He switched big time. Now he's talking about Ms. Drudge again. Wow. So many phonies in so little time. That's our poll question today. We kind of got away from it because I'm all whipped up into a frenzy here. What well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? Rush Limbaugh, 138. Big fat turd. Bill O'Reilly's got the 37, second place. Kathy Lee Gifford, 20. Hate that bitch. Jimmy Swaggart, 15. Miss Mac Drudge, he's got 13. The Pope, 12. Ann Coulter, 10. Lynn Cheney's got 6. And Nancy Grace has only got 1. And not that we like her, but she's small
right.
Potatoes in this crowd.
Nobody watches court TV.
WQAM, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Neil, I'm curious. You said vote yes on 4, and I initially felt the same way, too, but just wonder how you feel about it from the other perspective. I know you're a dog lover, and, you know, the dog tracks are known to be somewhat
offensive. Sir, some woman called me a few weeks ago with this crap. Let me say it again. If they want to eliminate greyhound racing, They can work on doing that, okay? They have a point. I understand what they're talking about. But why do we want to punish, first of all, the kids in the education system in the state? Why do we want to punish all the other paramutuals because there are people opposed to the dog tracks? That's a pretty stupid, you know, voting against this isn't going to close down the dog tracks.
That's a good point. Do you think that are people really still going to the dog tracks in mass? Because this is definitely going to bring them back.
Let me ask you this. If you had a chance of going, like, let's say, to either Pompano Park or Calder or Gulfstream, place like that, or going to one of the dog tracks, where would you go if you want to go to play the slots?
It's tough, because it's all abusive, really. But I guess probably
In addition to which, Biscayne doesn't even exist anymore, so how many dog tracks are we talking about? You're talking about Flagler and Palm Beach Kennel Club. There's only a couple left anyway.
True. Very true.
Yes, Pally. Don't forget, Prop 4, vote yes. I'm not going to go through a whole song that again. That's just the dog. Yeah, I am a dog lover, okay, and I do understand the people about the breeding of the greyhounds
right.
And all that other stuff. I've talked about it.
Different issue.
Huh?
It's a different issue.
It is a different issue. It's like the pet of people with the same
right.
cat. Every time any issue comes along, they bring in that whole bunch of crap, too. I'm surprised they're not on the bandwagon on this.
They are.
Somebody speaking about the bandwagon, Geldy. He's on a wagon. Well, he's on tonight at Smoky Bone, 7 o'clock. Yeah, he makes an appearance like Monday and Wednesday and every once in a while. And Jim Sarney, so that Geldy wouldn't be forgotten, writes last Friday. Now, did you talk about this?
No.
You didn't?
Just that one line.
He says, Thursday night was supposed to be opening night for the Panthers. Remember them, the Panthers?
No.
Who?
The Philadelphia Flyers were coming to town. Steve Goldstein was scheduled to call his first hockey game for WQAM. Instead of being at the Orpheus Depot Center on Thursday, Goldie was at the Orange Bowl during the Hurricanes pregame show as the Hurricanes once again escaped defeat at the hands of another girls' team. Well, it's just amazing how they keep slipping off the hook, isn't it, Josh?
Louisville was ranked.
Get out of here. They're rank. You put too many letters at the end of that. They're rank. Another very marginal team at best. The ghost of Howard Schmelleberger hangs over Louisville. At any rate, the NHL season. And how about those Dolphins?
Oh.
All right. Not everybody can be perfect. The Patriots are perfect. The Jets so far are perfect, which is amazing. The Eagles are perfect. And the Dolphins are perfect.
Oh!
The NHL season, well, I better do the break, then I'll get back to this.
All right.
We had so many breaks, huh? We got a lot of breaks. We got some business on the log here. Might as well get it done. Boy, that thing this morning, I could write a book just about that 5 minutes, or whatever it took, 10 minutes. I could write a book about it. Muff. Stay the hell away, okay, you silly person, you. 4 minutes till noon at 560 WQAM. You've heard me talk about dry concepts on this show for over 20 years, and nothing has changed. Because when it comes to having your carpet, furniture, drapery clean, the only people you need to be thinking about is dry concepts. I've been using them in my home for over 20 years, too. Let's face it, your carpet is as bad as your sink when it comes to collecting germs. There's a lot of schmutz in there, even if you don't know what that means. So call Dry Concepts today and have them sanitize your home. They've got certified technicians you can trust. They'll dry clean your carpet, same idea as dry cleaning your clothing, and the stains go away and don't come back. Now, beware of those $5.95 per room scams, because I guarantee you, no rip-offs when you do business with Dry Concepts. They give you a written, guaranteed price before they start the job, and Dry Concepts uses a rapid drying technique, so your carpets are dry in just an hour and a half. You really can clean today and entertain tonight. So whether it's your carpeting, your area rugs, your oriental rugs, your drapery, all of these things, these are the folks you want to trust. In Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach, call them toll-free at 1-800-248-5071. On the web, it's dryconcepts.com. Or call them at 1-800-248-5071. Dry Concepts, making carpets clean in South Florida since 1979.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560.
This is Dick Cheney. I like to relax by having Mary Magdalene massage my balls while listening to the Neil Rogers 12 to 1 hour.
American girls and American guys who only listen to the message from the Uber ride will have their table talk flying. As the troops come home dead, they find the comfort of denial hiding under the bed. I never served in the army. I'm too afraid to fight. So I sit right here near the TV, far from liberal lies. Under their covers, you'll discover I'm a big sissy. Bill would prefer to have some other do the fighting for me. Now this country I love is occupying Iraq, and all the suckers like me whose necks are red in the back have our tongues all placed firmly in Bush's big brown eye. The big mouth cowards of the world who gladly follow blind. Hey, Uncle Sam, I'm too afraid to fight or enlist, but you can count on me to watch TV and shake my fist, and my flag will fly from the back of my truck like an idiotic, pseudo-patriotic.
Just stop what I think.
And my view of the whole wide world is what I see on Fox News. Yeah, I'm an armchair warrior. Who knows better than you? I'm an inbred jerk who parrots anything they say. Don't have to read or research. It's so much easier this way to watch TV or look at pictures in USA Today. With my...
I mean, gestapotactics.
As I tickle my brain. Hey, Uncle Sam, I'm too afraid to fight or enlist, but you can count on me to watch TV and shake my fist as I lower my fly so I can pull on my...
As long as I...
To proudly show the swastika tattooed on my...
That's not right.
The Saudis are our best friends in the world, not those Iraqis or Jews.
Oy.
Yeah, I'm an armchair warrior. Who knows better than you?
Anyway, it's 1204 560 WQAM. Here's a couple of good faxes for our poll today. Biggest phony, Phil Henry.
Are you sure?
How do you like that? Claims to be a Democrat, right? That's what it says on the fax, sure. Also, speaking of Phil, how about Dr. Phil, right?
Right.
Absolutely.
Good choice. I think he might be the winner. He might edge out the Pill Pop and Rush. We'll see. Get them both on there, please.
They love Rush.
Well, maybe you got some in your back pocket there, huh? If you don't, I know somebody in the building who probably does. Anyway, Miss Sarney says at the Sun Sentinel Friday, the NHL season is on ice and the hockey broadcast booth is dark. Not too many of the voters are going to be allowed to be dark, but the hockey booth, the broadcast booth is dark. It's more disappointing than anything, said Geldy, who was named to succeed the legendary Jigs McDonald, who retired at the end of last season. But I'm still confident that there will be hockey this season, said Geldy. I don't think the players want to give away a whole season and know the league needs an economic change.
Ow! Right.
Goldie remains busy working for the Panthers and doing talk shows at WQAM, where he can be heard Monday and Wednesday nights and Saturday mornings. Goldie bolsters a lineup that needs as many familiar voices as it can get in its battle with ESPN Radio Waxy 790 AM. How do you like that? That's what Miss Sarney says. Goldie says, I'm enjoying doing the shows by myself. This is one of the great paragraphs in the history of broadcast journalism. I enjoy doing the shows by myself, said Goldstein, who was teamed with Howard David in a poorly conceived morning show.
Absolutely.
Before Howard Stern banished AM Sports at WQAM. You get the real diehard fans at night. They're more knowledgeable than the casual fans who call during the morning. They talk about anything. Right. They're a bunch of drunks who are up at night, of course, who have no life. I mean, who the hell's listening to radio at night anymore? Let's see. Here's a fax that goes on from Carol. Welcome back. Get Howard to go off the air at 10. No chance. Well, he's only going to be on another 15 months anyway. And then the whole thing's going to blow up in Greg's face again like it always does, you know? Well, nice try one more time. Try to put those pieces of the puzzle back together again. Anyway, here's a thing, an article about Without a Doubt. And Madonna and J-Lo for the poll, both of them.
Aye.
Let's see. If you haven't read it and link it in your website. Ron Suskind called Without a Doubt, New York Times, October 17, which would have been yesterday, the last time I checked. Your website won't come up on MSN. I'm a daily listener, so stuck with listening on the radio today. Has anyone else reported this as a problem? Get your Cracker Jack staff working on it, if so. Our website won't come up on MSN? What's that all about?
I don't know. MSN is kind of insidious. You know, it's Microsoft's own.
Right.
Exploit.
I know what it is.
Yeah, well, I don't like
crap.
It.
At any rate, that's what she says. And, of course, you don't fax me the article, so I don't have it.
I don't have the article.
Oh.
She said she wasn't going to fax it, which we thank her for that.
Oh, because it's too long. Well, right. If I have time, I can't do it in the middle of the show. She reminds me of my financial guy that keeps emailing me in the middle of my show, expecting me to, like, drop everything and email him and call him about nothing, just to say, oh, I got this, I got that. I got Cirrus is what I got, baby. I work for QAM. That's what I got. I got Cirrus. Anyway, would you please discuss Amendment 3 on the Florida ballot? The proponents are doctors and opponents are lawyers. I don't know which group of professional parasites, thieves, and liars to believe things. I don't even know what the hell it says. How am I going to discuss it? I don't know what it's all about. Do you?
No.
Proposition 3?
Oh, the medical thing. Yeah, I know what it's about.
Oh, is that about limiting? That's about limiting
lawsuits.
Right, lawsuits, malpractice suits.
Vote no.
Vote absolutely no,
no
on that, okay? As much as we dislike lawyers, we dislike butchered doctors 1,000 times more because most lawyers aren't hazardous to your health. They're hazardous to your pocketbook, but they're not hazardous to your health as opposed to the butchered doctors, which is about, I would say, 90% of the people who call themselves doctors in South Florida.
They want
butchers.
A blanket settlement for any time they kill
right.
you.
You that's
get,
right.
Here's a check for a grand. There you go. Shut up.
And by the way, how's what's-her-name doing with a tube in her thing?
Tube of what?
Toothpaste. In Fort Myers today, Edwards accuses Bush of when you're off for 5 days like that, you've got so much to catch up on. See, that's like a little subliminal thing again. Teresa Hines, Carrie C., another little thing there for the Kerry campaign. It's subliminal.
Opinion about the debates. A lot of them didn't watch, or if they watched, they didn't pay a great deal of attention. They didn't really make up their minds. And among those people, that constituency, which really wasn't moved one way or the other by the debates, Bush has a 2-1 lead. My guess is these are people who are making up their mind very late as the campaign draws to a close, and it appears that, again, the terrorism issue is the foremost issue for those voters.
Right. That's why he's doing such a great job, like I said, against biochemical attacks. We can't even take care of the people in the country who need their influenza shots, their flu shots, and this guy is going to protect you against a biological or chemical attack. Who the hell are you kidding, man? Talk about stupid. And, you know, I've been pondering this in my mind for several weeks, and I haven't said it on the air, but I really believe this. Although they might still pull out that October surprise sometime in the next 2 weeks and say, hey, guess what? We just got Osama. Here he is. And meantime, they might have had him locked away for, like, months, for all we know. I don't think they want to get him.
No, I know.
I think there's a deal between Bush, and right off the bat there was a deal between Bush and the Saudis that we don't want to get him. So, you know, Kerry and Edwards keep bringing up about we had him cornered in the mountains of Tora Bora, and we did this, and we outsourced the job to the warlords instead of using our best military to go get him. I don't think they want to get him. Capiche?
I understand.
Because that would be bad for business.
Sure enough.
Anyway, Senator John Edwards accused President Bush today of exploiting a national tragedy for personal gain in a blistering speech in Fort Myers preceding Bush's own address about terrorism in the state in the shadow of the 9/11 attacks. George Bush today is making one last stand to con the American people into believing that he's the only one who can fight and win the war on terrorism, Edwards said. John Kerry defended this country as a young man. He'll defend the country as president of the U.S., which we've heard that how many times this week?
About 30, man.
On a day that promised to be dominated by talk of terrorism, the North Carolina senator sought to put Bush on the defensive as the president headed in what his aides called a major speech on terrorism in southern New Jersey. Edwards, speaking at a seaside park in this battleground state, argued that Bush claims steady leadership but offers a steady stream of failure. He accused the president of creating a new haven for terrorists and assailed him for failing to capture the mastermind of the attacks, the just aforementioned Osama Yamama bin Laden. He'll fail in the war against terrorism because he doesn't know how to lead, Edwards said of Bush. Accusing the president of using scare tactics, Edwards charged, George Bush is playing on people's deepest fears. He's exploiting a national tragedy for personal gain, and it's the lowest kind of politics. Oh, here's another good one, phony. This is an excellent choice for our pool. Condoleezza. Let's play the original one today.
Oh!
That would solve a lot of problems. Right?
Yeah.
That would eliminate all of this bickering back and forth between two overgrown children, with me in the middle. It says, I would like to nominate Condoleezza as the biggest phony around. Her credentials are celebratory at best. She's possibly the biggest token ever. She has absolutely no credibility.
Absolutely.
Take into consideration that her greatest ambition is to one day become commissioner of the National Football League. Well, she's going to have to get her teeth fixed first. I'll tell you that right now. Gap-toothed bitch. Oh, that's Dr. Rice, Neil. That's Dr. Rice. Oh, sorry. What did I just get you saying about doctors? Okay, what well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? We got a few votes. What do we got? 320. Rush Limbaugh, 172. Bill O'Reilly, 44. Kathy Lee Gifford, 27. Jimmy Swagger, 22. The Pope, 17. Miss Drudge, 15. Ann Coulter, 12. Lynn Cheney's got 7. Dennis Miller's got 2. Dr. Phil, 1. Nancy Grace's got 1. And the other ones, so far, got the big O. Condoleezza just went on there. J-Lo and Madonna have got the big
O. Oh!
You want to know why?
Why?
Small teeters.
The Howard Stern Show. Neil Rogers, mornings and midday.
They ask for
sports around the clock. 560 QAM.
Only in the Banana Republic, baby. Only in Miami.
Right now on Access Hollywood.
George, the new Kitty Kelly book? It makes you and your family look bad. Have you read it yet?
We're...
Oh, that's right. I forgot. You can't read. Sorry.
They're Abu Ghraib.
Explosive action.
You know, Bill, you should really learn how to read.
Basically, I
can't learn.
You notice how he says, Bill, you should learn how to read?
Yeah.
Notice that little slip there at the end? What the hell is that all about?
I don't know. Play it again.
12:06. I am going to play that a million times. 12:16 at 560 WQM. We got the Mad Dog at 2. I'm sure I'll be waxing enthusiastic about that great Dolphin game yesterday.
All right.
In Buffalo, no less. Boy, that was pathetic. That was tragic. God. And then we got the Humper at 4. Guilty, who's getting all that publicity from his good buddy Jim Cerny at 7 o'clock at Smoky Bones tonight. Eddie K at 10 tonight. We'll be talking about the dog track. Eddie's probably the last guy in town that talks about the Highline and the dog track, right?
Right.
How many people go there now, those places?
About 30, man.
5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless lines. WQAM, hello. QAM. Oh, and guess what also, speaking of Miss Little Miss Muffet, I had an email on Friday from Little Miss Muffet. Guess about what?
I don't know.
C-SPAN wanted to come in.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He mentioned something about that.
Yeah, C-SPAN wanted to come in and, like, tape the show and listen to the calls and hear the, I said, here's the short answer.
No.
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 Which letter didn't you understand, the N or the...
No.
Huh?
Oh!
The O.
Right. No chance. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil, I got one for you, Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah, Junior Seat, this team is out for some kind of vengeance.
Don't be putting Junior on there for crying out loud. He's playing well. Him and Zach Thomas and Jason Taylor, they're playing well. The rest of the team sucks.
Get the honey, Junior.
Yeah. Junior Seau, get out of here, will you? How's that Wanstead error coming along? Is that as good as the roadmap?
It's the Wanstead error.
All right. The Wanstead error. Not bad. There's your article for tomorrow, Dave Hyde. WQAM, hello.
What for your poll, Larry King?
Oh, I like that a lot. Thank you so much.
Uh-huh.
So how much of this article do you want? Because Carol...
I don't want any of it.
Oh, great. 10 pages.
How many? No, 11. How could I do that?
11 pages now.
But if you send me the first... Just send me the first page, and then I can look it up. It's in yesterday's Times, right?
Yes.
I can look it up, and I can peruse it, and I can we can link it.
It's on its
How's
way.
How's that? We can stick it. 5670560, the most, the biggest phony on the face of the globe. That's our poll question today. Rush, I don't know. I think Dr. Phil may catch him, though. You might be surprised.
He'll do well, but...
He's going to make a big movement.
No, he ain't no right.
You'll smell it. WQAM, hello.
Did Jim Sarney really write Steve Goldstein's on the QAM lineup to boost the lineup?
That's what Jim Sarney wrote.
That's not a good sign.
The actual word was bolster. Goldie Bolster.
The Bulger. No, he didn't say bolster. He said to bulger the lineup. Isn't Pete Bulger the assassin? Line. Yeah. WQAM, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Neil. How are you?
Okay, good.
What's really more aggravating than listening to these people talk about the polls and everything else is hearing people around you. I got a guy who works with me, University of Miami graduate on philosophy and so forth, saying he's going to vote for Bush because he's easier to contradict.
Oh, that's great. That makes a lot of sense. Uh-huh.
Yeah. No, well, it's a UM graduate. What do you expect?
Oh, well, that speaks for itself.
And Mo Howard Day was pretty good the other day, too. He was just about kissing Wanstead, saying he liked him so much. Why don't we just both leave town?
Are you serious? How do you like that? I can't believe that. Did he say that? Was he sucking up to the Wanstead era?
He's going to like Wanstead. Howard's a Jets fan.
Well, that's right. And who could do better for the Jets than Dave Wanstead? Hey, Dave, you're not fooling anybody, okay? You're useless, you're hopeless, you're pathetic, you're tragic, you're an embarrassment, you're humiliating, your team blows, okay? They couldn't beat a girls' team. And it goes to show you how desperate that game was yesterday. Did you notice, Josh, that both teams had first and goal on a one-yard line?
Yeah, somebody had to win.
And, huh?
Somebody had to win.
But neither team could stick it in the end zone from first and goal on a one-yard line. And neither team could stick it in there.
That's
how do you like
man.
That? And if you can't stick it in there, man, you just, what can I say? Not much anymore. Ron Suskind, so here's that article. Should I read the first paragraph?
Please.
Bruce Bartlett, because you only sent me the first page, so it would, like, tail off anyway.
That's a teaser.
Bruce Bartlett, a domestic policy advisor to Ronald Reagan and Treasury official for the first President Bush, told me recently that if Bush wins, there will be a civil war in the Republican Party starting on November 3rd. The nature of that conflict, as Bartlett sees it, essentially the same as the one raging across much of the world, a battle between modernist and fundamentalist, pragmatist and true believers, reason and religion. Just in the past few months, Bartlett said, I think a light has gone off for people who've spent time up close to Bush that this instinct he's always talking about is this sort of weird, messianic idea of what he thinks God has told him to do. Bartlett, a 53-year-old columnist and self-described libertarian Republican who's lately been a champion for traditional Republicans concerned about Bush's governance, went on to say, this is why George W. Bush is so clear-eyed about al-Qaeda and the Islamic fundamentalist enemy. He believes you have to kill them all. They can't be persuaded. They're extremists driven by a dark vision. He understands them because he's just like them. Oh, and speaking of that, that's all I'm going to read to that.
Oh, I want more.
Check that out. Huh?
I want more of that.
No, no, but listen.
Okay.
You notice how Al-Zarqawi now has joined up over the weekend? He's become one of them. Now he's al-Qaeda.
Sure.
He was his own lunatic before, mm-hmm. and he's the one responsible for the kidnappings and the beheadings. But now all of a sudden he's with al-Qaeda because we're against him, so he's against us.
People who were enemies are now getting together against us.
That's right. So in other words, if we're somebody else's enemy, then we're going to be everybody's enemy because either you're with us or against us. And come to find out, we got all these people against us. What a surprise. Well, guess what? In a break with tradition, the Tampa Tribune, a Republican standard bearer for decades, the Tampa Tribune refused yesterday to endorse either candidate for president for the first time since 1964 when they told Barry Goldwater, get lost. Remember that?
I do.
I do. No, you don't. The Tribune became the second GOP-oriented daily to balk at endorsing the Republican incumbent. The Winston-Salem Journal also refused to endorse either candidate. The Tribune has solidly reported every Republican presidential nominee since 52 except for Goldwater, but withheld its endorsement this year, calling the decision achingly difficult and blaming shortcomings of both candidates. Editors instead published an unusual full-page editorial with harsh criticism of the war in Iraq and President Bush's economic policies. President Bush told us that he was a uniter, not a divider, but shortly after taking office, his administration took a sharp right turn that's divided this country, the editorial said. The newspaper said it was deeply
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, being in the advertising and marketing thing, I've really enjoyed the Greg Reed show over the last few years. It's really been fun to listen to him do whatever he does there. The morning guy will finish out his contract, or do you think they'll end up booting him off for a while before it ends?
I mentioned that to George this morning because there's a lot of stuff I've been reading when I was on vacation this last week. I've been reading tons of stuff about the possibility that Infinity might want to cut him loose because all he... I mean, I don't listen to his show, but all
there's no way out of that for them. I think this is a no-win situation. In order to... Actually, the only thing they can do is try to hurt him by putting him off the air and hopefully lose listenership.
Yeah.
Before I go, I want to ask you something. Can you play the Mo promo for the other station? You played it a while ago when he first did it. Being in marketing, I really enjoyed that one.
Okay, I'll find it. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Now, that was, where the hell is that?
I don't know.
Oh, you know something? We had to take
out. That's right. We had to get rid of
it. We were required to remove that from the DCS, so I don't have it. I thought it was funny as hell.
Sure.
Absolutely.
But these people, everything is uptight and whatever mood this one is in today and what side of the bed this one got up on and who was on the other side of it at the time, all this other bullcrap. Like I said, we work for a bunch of emotional cripples, for a bunch of crazy people. And I'm going to be here every day when I'm supposed to be, just like clockwork, collecting those checks, and that's it for the next 2 years and 2 months. And that's it, baby. I must have been a crazy person. I must have been losing my mind to think that I want to subject myself to these nut jobs for another 2 years. Who the hell needs it? If this audience, I'm not going to take the time, it's too personal, I'm not going to bore you with all the details, but if you had any idea of the way these people conduct business, and I do mean monkey business, you just shake your head and say, this is a business? This is a place of business?
No.
Because this station isn't about you people, it's not about our sponsors, it's not about even making money. This station is all about Greg. That's all it's all about. There's nothing else that counts. How he feels today, what kind of a mood he's in, is he pissed off, is he taking us the wrong way, did he like the tone of this show or that show? That's what it's all about. And quite frankly, who the hell needs that? And then of course he's got his buffers, he's got the intermediaries, he's got the people, the messenger boy and the messenger girl, the water Nazi, all these other silly people. I'll pass on that. 27 past noon at 560 WQM. Hey, don't pass on great shoes and deals at Brandy's in Pompano Beach, because for a long, long time now, Brandy's has been legendary when it comes to fitting you up with the best in brand name shoes at unbeatable prices, too, and top quality service. In fact, at Brandy's, they may even recognize you by the smell of your feet. All the top quality names in the business are waiting for you, like Rockport's, Florsheim, SAS, Sperry, Timberland Naturalizer, and all the others, too. And people generally buy several pair in each visits because they can save so much cash. Brandy's is open daily Monday through Saturday from 9 a.m. till 9 p.m. every Sunday 10 to 5, and you'll find Brandy's at 1290 North Federal Highway in Pompano Beach. It's always worth a trip from anywhere you might be. And right now, it's a great time to get a great deal at Brandy's, because this week, take 50% off on all Red Tag men's and women's famous brands throughout the store. 50%. So come in or visit their website, brandyshoes.com. You can't beat them with a skirt.
Listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM. They were Nelson. Did you know we come from a showbiz family?
Matthew and Gunnar Nelson were the children of Ricky Nelson, a 50s rock and roll star who himself was the son of a famous TV father, Ozzy. No, not Ozzy Osbourne.
Who does our freaking research around here?
Sorry.
The thing about being twins is that we have a psychic sense of what the other is feeling. And when we had a hit song, we both had this premonition that very soon we would go right into the toilet and never be heard from again.
Man, twins share so much. Like really sucking. It's a big, juicy, sopping wet look at show business. Tonight on Inside the Behind.
12:32, now back in the day I might have had some response for that, but I guess we probably better not. Anyway, here's a fax from Chip who says, looking at the results of your poll, I think people generally don't get what a phony is. We better understand the enemy if we expect to win this war/election. A propagandist like Limbaugh is no phony. He really believes all the bullshit he spews on the air every day, and there are many just like him that should put the fear of God or whatever you believe in you. Just think Ann Coulter, that bitch, or Sean Hannity. How come he's not on the poll?
He is not.
Oh. The real phony on your list is that two-faced son of a bitch Dennis Miller, says Chip. Well, what do you really think, Chip? Man, just calm down a little bit, okay? 2 weeks from tomorrow is the election. We got the voting going on, the early voting in Florida today, and the computers are all screwed up, and they're having all kinds of problems, and it's a nightmare. Anybody really think their vote is going to count?
No.
I'll give it a shot anyway. And like I've told you before, vote several times just to make sure that one of them might get counted. Right?
Right. Vote early, vote absentee, and then show up on the second.
Right. Early and often, if you're for Kerry. If you're Bush, stay home. He's got it locked. You know, look at the polls, right, man. Yeah, He's got it locked anyway, all you Bush people. Just stay home. Go to church. Just fondle your rosary beads and your Bibles and all your crucifix. All that crap. The National Security Advisor under the first President Bush says the current president acted contemptuously toward NATO and Europe after 9/11. And is trying to cooperate now out of desperation to rescue a failing venture in Iraq and Afghanistan. Brent Scowcroft, a mentor to the current National Security Advisor, Condoleezza Rice, that's Dr. Rice, also said in an interview published in England that Bush is inordinately influenced by Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon.
Oy!
Sharon just has him wrapped around his little finger, Scowcroft told London's Financial Times. I think the president is mesmerized. Maybe he's bringing him some good deli. Scowcroft said the Bush administration's unilateralist position was partly responsible for the post-9/11 decline of the transatlantic relationship. It's in general bad, he said, not really hostile, but there's an edge to it. Early on, he said, we'd gotten contemptuous of Europeans and their weaknesses. We had really turned unilateral. Although slightly diminished since then, the unilateralist policies remain fundamentally little changed, Scowcroft said. Recent overtures to cooperate in Afghanistan and Iraq with the UN and NATO was as much of an act of desperation as anything else to rescue a failing venture. On Israel and Sharon, the former security advisor said, Sharon calls Bush after strongly retaliating for a Palestinian suicide attack and says, I'm on the front line of terrorism, and the president says, yes, you are. Scowcroft said Sharon has been nothing but trouble. A big, fat pile of right-wing trouble. And he is...
absolutely correct, sir.
Now, let's take a few more calls, and I want to get into these endorsements.
Okay.
I'm going to read them.
Good.
The Herald endorses Kerry.
Oh!
The Sun Sentinel endorses Kerry.
Oh!
The Atlanta Journal-Constitution, I'm not going to read that one, but they endorse Kerry.
Oh!
The Palm Beach Post endorsed John Kerry.
Oh!
And even the Tampa Tribune didn't endorse anybody and had a scathing renunciation of the 4 years of the Bushmeister on their paper over the weekend. The Tampa Tribune, as right-wing as it gets. The Chicago Tribune, of course, endorsed Bush because what do you expect? And along with a couple of other fascist newspapers. Who do you think the New York Post is going to endorse? Huh? That's a tough one. Oh, look at this goofball.
And he should be proud of it, like President Bush is proud to be a conservative.
Another right-wing, self-hating schwarzer there, man. Unbelievable. Anyway, let's take some calls. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Hey, is this Neil?
Sounds like me.
Hey, Neil, how you doing?
Good.
How come Dave Wannstedt's not on the poll? He's kind of a phony coach, right?
WQAM, hello. QAM.
Yes, Neil?
Yes, sir.
Hey, great to have you back. I got one for your poll.
Yes, sir, go ahead.
And that would be Tucker Carlson.
Oh, I love it.
He's an idiot.
You know who, John Stewart from The Daily Show, did you see about that or see the clips of it?
I've been seeing, not about that one, but I've
on Crossfire Friday, he ripped him and Paul Vigal an ass.
Oh,
it was great. Said the show is nothing but show business and it's phony and it's a bunch of crap and they kiss everybody's ass. It was fantastic. Just about flipped his bow tie right off Tucker Carlson. So put him on there, okay? Piece of crap, piece of turd.
It's been good lately, that Daily Show.
I thought you were going to say Crossfire.
Oh, no, no.
I thought maybe you were losing.
I never used to like The Daily Show.
Smoking some really bad Schmidt.
Until this political thing.
Let's see. Here's one for the poll. George W. Now, he's not phony. He's exactly what you see. We're not putting him on there. He's exactly what you see is what you get. When they invented that expression, what you see is what you get, they must have had him in mind. It.
Juicy?
Or maybe they had the thing in mind. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Yeah, hello. Can I speak to Neil?
Speaking.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
I got a poll for your, I got a nominee for your poll.
Yeah.
You've heard that before.
Yes, I have.
Maury Povich.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Murray. Okay, Murray Povich. Okay, you got it, man. Murray Povich. I wonder if he's kin to Murray the K. Or maybe Brian Murray.
They don't speak like that.
Their spokesman, ever their spokesman, Brian Murray?
Yes.
They don't speak like that. Okay, Maury Povich, yeah, you're right about that.
With the crippled children and all that.
Yeah, well. And now, is that just before he does the show with the dwarfs?
Oh, that's...
WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I got a Wayne Heinzinga for your poll.
Wayne Heinzinga, yeah.
And then,
nobody has been fired yet? Aren't you amazed that nobody in the organization has gotten canned yet?
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, it's a
good
thing.
They couldn't win a fixed game.
It's a good thing that the Dolphins have had, rock-solid drafts in the last couple of years because the future
solid.
Looks bright. The future looks bright, man.
That's right. Okay, we got a shot, man. Okay, you got it, pal. Wayne Heinzinga. Got him?
Got it.
Phony. Although he was a phony for a while, and I think the day he stopped being phony was in 97 after the Marlins won the World Series for the first time, and he said, oh, I don't care about the fans. I'm in it for the money. Remember that?
Right.
You gotta break up the team and you gotta build me a stadium and you gotta do this and gotta, and shoulda. And in the meantime, go to hell, Wayne, okay? We don't like you. We can't stand you. And what you're putting on the field there every Sunday, man, is an embarrassment. It's humiliating and degrading. It's perfect, though. Perfect crap is what it is. Kinda like our governor and our president. Perfect crap. Boy, that fat ass governor, man, he really frosts my ass, you know what? But let me say it again, since it is early voting in Florida and there are people voting right now as I speak. The people of Florida put his ass in there again and the rest of them too. So stop and think about that. That should convince you beyond a shadow of a doubt, plus all these early voting irregularities, that you ought to be voting 40, 50, at least 60 times.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
Greg hates you.
Are you ready for some football? Then tune in to ESPN Gay.
And he hits the hole right after Jesse opens it up.
Oh, yeah. ESPN Gay.
I can pack that guy around third.
Cowboys, Bears, Vikings, Packers. You'll get them all on ESPN Game.
He's going to fire into his guy right here.
Feel the sweat.
You push, you push, you push.
Smell the passion.
You just rode him backwards.
You just put him right on his back.
This ain't some makeover show on Bravo. It's the NFL on ESPN Game.
And then everyone's kind of slopping around down there and grunting and groaning. And, you know, you get mud and stuff flying and getting tackles and scrums and quagmires.
ESPN Game, where there's never a wardrobe malfunction.
I don't know where that one came from.
Sundays will never be the same.
That looked like it was the last shot out of the Roman candle.
Call your cable operator now and demand ESPN Game.
Look at that big old meat lump. What a meal those guys are having.
That looks good.
ESPN Game. Now that's a mouthful.
Rectum.
Top 45 at 560 WQM. I think I'm getting a sore throat.
Oh, no.
How do you like that? Doesn't that sound promising?
No.
No. 465 votes. What well-known person do you think is the biggest phony, we asked today? Rush Limbaugh, 220. Nobody's going to touch Rush, and what a horrible thought that is anyway. Bill O'Reilly, 56. Jimmy Swaggart, 35. Kathy Lee Gifford, 31. The Pope's got 20. Altar Boys. Dr. Phil, 19. Miss Drudge, 16. Ann Coulter, 13. Condoleezza is moving up fast. She's got 11. That's Dr. Rice. J-Lo, 9. Dennis Miller, 9. Lynn Cheney, 8. Madonna's got 7. Phil Henry's got 6. He just went on there a little bit ago. He's already starting to climb. Larry King, 2. Wayne Heisinger's got 1. Sean Hannity, 1. Nancy Grace, 1. And Maury Povich and Tucker Carlson went on just, they have the big,
oh!
They don't have any, yeah, they will. So anyway, the Ron Suskind article, without a doubt, from yesterday's New York Times Magazine, which is where it was, it's in Eric's hands.
All right.
So it'll be on our website sometime very soon, I'm sure. I'm sure any moment now. Because it's the kind of thing Eric does to make it, you know, suck around a little bit, make it seem like he's right on top of things, right?
Hmm?
Byron William writes, bogus polls mask landslide in the making. Oh, if this were only true. It was on our website this weekend. He says, conventional wisdom suggests this year's presidential election will be close. Practically every poll taken has the race within the margin of error. At the risk of looking like a fool, he says, I'm prepared to respectfully disagree with conventional wisdom to offer the following contrarian perspective. This election will not be close. Before you sit down to your computer to begin your Williams, have you lost your mind rant, hear me out. I've reached this conclusion for two reasons. My first reason is shaped by what the polls can't see. When I was in Philadelphia last week, the Philadelphia Inquirer ran a story in the local section that addressed increased voter registration. The final day of registration in Pennsylvania and New Jersey last week brought huge crowds to registration offices. As of September, Philadelphia had received 219,000 applications from either new voters or those who had moved or had been stricken from the rolls. With some 60,000 applications arriving on the final day, it is possible the city's volume this year could break the record of 293 applications set in the tension-filled mayoral race of 83 between Wilson Good and Frank Rizzo. This trend of increased voter registration is replicated in particular in a majority of the battleground states. According to the New York Times, voter registration campaigns in heavily Democratic areas have added tens of thousands of new voters to the rolls in swing states of Ohio and Florida, a surge that far exceeds the efforts of Republicans in both states. The analyzation by the Times of county-by-county data shows that in Democratic areas of Ohio, especially low-income and minority neighborhoods, new registration since January have risen 250% over the same period in 2000. In comparison, new registrations have increased just 25% in Republican areas. A similar pattern is apparent in Florida. In the strongest Democratic areas, the pace of new registration is 60% higher than 4 years ago, while it's risen just 12% in the heaviest Republican areas. Project Votes says it's registered 147,000 new voters in Ohio. Americans Coming Together said that together with the allied groups that are part of America Votes, it's registered 300,000 new voters in New Mexico. The Secretary of State's office reports that since May, voter registration has jumped from approximately 958,000 to a little more than a million, possibly all new registrants. Those younger than 30,
about 30, man,
who are increasingly concerned about a potential draft are also registering in increased numbers. These new registrants are not considered in most polling. A growing number of young people use cell phones as their primary phone number. This further diminishes the possibility that their support for either candidate would be reflected in the polling data. They're the greatest unknown in this election. My second reason, if history is any barometer, is that when incumbent presidents seek re-election, it's a referendum on the previous 4 years. Since 1932, 11 incumbent presidents have sought re-election, with the possible exceptions of 48 and 76. None of the races have even been close. When we want to keep a president, we keep him. Roosevelt, Eisenhower, Johnson, Nixon, Reagan, and Clinton are prime examples. Likewise, when we want him out, he's out. Hoover, Carter, and Bush 41. More and more, this race is shaping up like 1980. That race stayed close until the last few weeks when voters found a comfort level with then-challenger Ronald Reagan that allowed them to oust President Carter. It's difficult for me to believe the race is as close as the polls indicate, especially when one considers that 56% of the electorate feels the country's headed in the wrong direction. Moreover, it's been 16 months since 50% felt we were headed in the right direction. I don't believe we'll be in court discussing hanging, dimpled, or pregnant chads on November 30, predicts. Well, we can only pray for that, right?
I'll sacrifice the chicken.
Right. Only cross our legs and rub them together like a grasshopper and pray like hell. 567-0560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless line. WQAM, hello.
Greetings.
Yes, sir.
Powerful article. I enjoyed that. Listen, your poll, there's a glaring omission. I can't believe no one's mentioned this.
Uh-huh.
Oprah.
Oh, yeah. Phony
the
bitch.
Queen of plastic, supercilious crap.
Right.
I mean, I can't believe. But back to your article, that says so much it's true with the cell phones and the do not call lists and all that. The polling this year is almost worthless.
And among the younger voters, by the way, 18 to 29 carries way the hell ahead.
Right. And, you know, again, I'll say it, any adult who has children who votes for Bush, your children's blood is going to be on your hands, okay?
Amen. In fact, anybody that all that votes for Bush, they got blood of dead Americans and Iraqis right now on their hands.
On the next Oprah, you'll be shocked. You'll be amazed. You'll be talking about it for the next however long until she shocks you again. Oprah makes your wildest dreams come true. Today, everyone in the studio audience, all 276 members, get a brand new liver.
Everybody gets a liver! Everybody gets a liver!
Then, tomorrow, all 276 studio audience members get a brand new uvula.
Everybody gets a brand new uvula! Everybody gets a brand new uvula!
The next day, all 276 members of the studio audience get a 3-foot helper monkey.
Everybody gets a 3-foot helper monkey!
The next day, all 276 audience members get a new prosthetic arm.
Everybody gets a prosthetic arm! Everybody gets a prosthetic arm!
Oprah, giving away great stuff she didn't have to pay for, even though she could easily afford to. And next season, everybody in the studio audience gets Stedman.
Everybody gets Stedman! Everybody gets Stedman!
How could we possibly forget
Oprah?
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Pally. A glaring omission on our part, wouldn't you say?
Indeed.
12:52 at 560 WQAM. I think I'm making a comeback. You know, I don't know why I'm drinking Fresca.
There you go.
You like Fresca?
It's all right.
It's a little on the fruity side.
Don't
but
normally
again,
find it around here. I mean, it's there. You just got
to
look.
Yeah, you're right. It's not easy to find. Anyway, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution in Atlanta, Georgia, endorses John Kerry.
Oh! All right.
After running through many of Bush's shortcomings, the newspaper said that Kerry offered a different kind of leadership, one informed both by the candidate's own interest in the world around him, as well as the competent people he surrounded himself with. I'm not going to read the whole thing because it goes on forever. It says, Bush has shown he lacks flexibility, competence, while Challenger looks for policies that will work. What a novel concept. So I'm not going to read that one. But I will read these. Miami Herald. The Herald recommends for U.S. President. Yesterday, October 17. I read this, I just about pooped in my pants. The Herald, which is usually so busy, although I think they endorsed Gore in 2000. I'm not really sure. I do believe. Maybe you want to research that.
Okay.
I don't know. I think they endorsed Gore. But then again, I'm not sure. This is what they said Saturday, or yesterday. Forced to confront a surprise attack on the homeland 3 years ago, President Bush rose to the challenge. He deserves credit for holding the nation together in a moment of great peril. But the president who came to office as a compassionate conservative has often displayed a narrow partisan. Our market system rewards efficiency and financial performance, but doesn't seem to reward growth and job creation. Our government has failed to counteract that trend, and as the world becomes more global and free trade takes hold, this will become an ever more important issue for the U.S. The debates have placed a spotlight on the skills and abilities of the two contenders, with the president getting the worst of it. In the three debates, Senator Kerry managed to erase the cartoon image of himself painted by the Republican spin machine. Mr. Kerry's sensible approach to the budget would be to reinstitute pay-as-you-go rules that require offsetting cuts of revenue to match new spending. He would eliminate tax cuts in the highest brackets. But it's in the international area that we believe Senator Kerry can most effectively lead our country at this time. The senator's approach, similar to that of Mr. Bush's father, seeks to engage the world through diplomacy rather than place the U.S. in a more combative path that isolates us from traditional friends and allies. His 19 years on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee have given him experience in a national security and foreign affairs, including Latin America, where a trade relationship needs attention. He supports NAFTA and FTAA and considers Miami the regional's key financial center. A promise to support but renegotiate free trade agreements, such as the pending Central America Accord, in order to obtain a better deal for dislocated workers, is a practical approach that could get this stalled plan through a hesitant Congress. As with every president for half a century, Israel will be an overriding foreign policy concern for the winner of the election. President Bush has been an unstinting supporter of Prime Minister Ariel Sharon, but unfortunately, there's been little follow-up to his own roadmap for peace following its rollout. Mr. Kerry, a longtime friend of Israel, has vowed to keep the White House engaged in an effort to achieve peace and security for the Jewish state, an indispensable ingredient for progress. The next president will almost surely have to nominate new Supreme Court justices. Mr. Kerry's promise to reward competence rather than ideology is reassuring. In the debates, Mr. Bush has also declared that he seeks only judicial wisdom, but his record of nominating controversial, ideologically extreme judges for the federal courts has sparked divisive debate in the Senate and is unnecessarily narrow criterion for appointment. On the basis of experience, a strong campaign, and command of issues that make this such a crucial election, the Miami Herald recommends John F. Kerry. Oh!
You're listening to Neil Rogers. On 560 QAM. Buttheads, it's the 1 to 2 hour.
Well, it's 1, 2, 3, the book by Kitty Kelly, but Bush denied Camp David's where he did some lines. Many rumors fly, always come out during campaign time. Well, 4, 5, 6, the habit he has kicked. He's no longer a druggie, it's libelous biography. Did some tune in his past. So boring because we could care less. Kitty Kelly, your books are mean. You're defaming our president. Trashy tabloid girl.
Don't forget, Kitty Kelly's mean, and John Kerry's not he's a bad person.
Yes.
That's what Lynn Cheney says. She's reassessed. Person. She's had a chance to reassess him, and he's a bad man. Because he said that their daughter's a dyke. That's what they said, that their daughter's a dyke. Her daughter's been out for years now. She's a gay activist. But, John Kerry said it, and John Edwards said it, too. And when John Edwards said it, Dick Cheney said, thank you for the kind words about me and my family.
That's right.
Yeah.
Kind of, yeah.
So it was okay when John Edwards said it. It was okay, certainly, when they said it, that our daughter's a bull dyke. But when John Kerry said that Mary Cheney was born that way, she's whatever she is, then all of a sudden he's a bad man. Because that's all they can do. You know, the L word, he's liberal. That's all they can do. They can't run in their own record because their record in every aspect of it is a freaking disaster. A disaster. Bob in Fort Lauderdale says, how about Donald Trump for the list? Oh, okay. You think he's a phony? I think he's what you see, you know. But nevertheless, we'll put him on it.
Sure.
Right?
Phony hair.
Yeah, well, bad hair. Gregory in Coral Springs says, all Democratic, he voted. Nice going, Greg. Go vote again now. It's only 1 o'clock. Although I was not too happy with Betty Castor. Yeah, but she makes a hell of an oil, baby. But I voted for her anyway and tried to break the Republican majority in the Senate. Vote for Betty Castor. Don't forget about that. Yes on Prop 4, no on Prop 3. And, of course, Kerry and Castor. This election is so important for our country in so many ways. Please, please, everyone out there, now is not the time to be lazy. They just might slip up and count one of your votes by accident. Also for our poll, he says, a total psychotic, I don't know if he can be termed a phony, referring to Michael Savage. We can put him on there, but he was on MSNBC for how many minutes?
About 30, man.
I think most people know who he is, although you're right about him. But thanks, Gregory. Thanks for the efforts. Thanks for the memories. Who's moving up now? Anybody moving up the poll? I don't want to keep reading these
numbers. The Jeffersons.
To the east side? Dr. Phil is moving up. He's got 23 votes. You see, but we gave Rush such a big head start. Dennis Miller's got 11. Well, we'll see how it all lays out by tomorrow, right?
Right.
These are just the early returns. The Gallup people, by the way, will make sure that Rush drops down a few notches. WQAM, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, good afternoon. Rudy Giuliani, who have made millions with the tragedy of the 9/11.
Yes.
And another old Jewish queen, Mayor Eddie Karch.
Oh, yeah. How do you like that piece of crap, huh?
I don't like it. And you? I'm sure you don't like it, either.
Not and you?
No, I don't.
Okay,
and
you are.
And if you want to put anybody local, the other mayor being.
Nah, we don't want to. There's
no. But Judy Giuliani is a cinch for that.
Yeah, absolutely. You can tell by that sneer on his face.
Okay, you have a
nice day. Yeah, the smirking ex-mayor, Rudy Giuliani, and who was the other one? Oh, Ed Koch. Spell it right now. Koch. How do you pronounce that? Koch. What a self-hating faggot! Unbelievable. Jews for Hitler, fags for David Duke. That's what we're dealing with there.
There must be a lot of money in that.
Bush. Huh?
Being a turncoat trader like that.
I don't know what goes on with some of these people, man, but what a disgrace and an embarrassment and humiliation. I mean, Zell Miller from Georgia, he's just a good old boy, redneck, we understand.
Yeah.
We'd expect no different from that piece of turd, but Ed Crotch? Man, I got news for you, baby. Most of them Bush people, they like to put your ass in the ovens for a whole bunch of reasons, just like mine. Sun Sentinel, presidential endorsement. Is this kind of long? It goes on. It's too long. But I'll just read this. Let's see. Okay. Just read a little bit. In the aftermath of 9/11, George W. Bush helped to unite the nation as it waged war against al-Qaeda. Unfortunately, his obsession with Saddam Hussein then caused him to lead the nation into an ill-conceived war in Iraq. Has Eric got that article up yet, by the way?
Yes.
Good. Nice going, Eric. Like I said, you're the best, fatso. So go to the website. There's one more reason for you to read that article by Ron, what was his name?
Kusey.
And, Kusey and Kusey? Is there anybody more obnoxious than Keith Olbermann on TV? Boy, he makes me want to see Ann Coulter.
Nancy Grace.
The way he folds the arms in that promo, you know, that sneer, and he's throwing the papers. Talk about contrived. How many people are watching Keith Olbermann on MSNBC?
About 30, man.
And that's it. Yeah, I wonder why. What a pompous ass. Anyway. That conflict, meaning Iraq, has caused more than 1,000 American lives, getting very close to 1,100, by the way, if you're keeping count, diverted resources from the fight against al-Qaeda and contributed to a hemorrhaging of red ink at the U.S. Treasury that threatens the economic foundation of the nation. In the process, the Bush administration has managed to squander international goodwill built up by U.S. presidents since the end of WW2. President Bush has failed the test of leadership. The South Florida Sun Sentinel editorial board recommends voters on November 2 replace him with John Kerry. The Massachusetts senator possesses a prodigious intellect capable of grasping the complexities of the serious issues facing the nation and the world. He surrounded himself with advisors who have equally sharp minds and proven track records, including former U.S. Chief Delegate to the UN, Richard Holbrooke, and former Secretary of the Treasury, Robert Rubin. The United States must chart new and constructive courses in foreign and fiscal policy, but this will happen only with more capable leadership than the Bush administration is able to provide. And it goes on point by point on Iraq, on the deficit, on the, it says the highest standard, No Child Left Behind, how they've blown that. In fact, I'm going to read that part.
Okay.
Well, no, because it's got some interesting crap. It says, while we consider Iraq and fiscal policy to be the salient issues in the campaign, several others cause us to be more comfortable with Kerry than with Bush. Supreme Court vacancies are likely to develop in the next 4 years, and Kerry would be more inclined to nominate jurists who would respect existing precedents, like Roe v. Wade, for example. Kerry understands the potential of embryonic stem cell research. His approach to it would impose vigorous ethical standards, but still enable the research to move forward and expand. While Bush was on the right track with the No Child Left Behind Act, a Kerry administration would be more likely to provide the funding that would enable it to be fully implemented. The same applies to comprehensive medical insurance reform. The detestable character assassination efforts aimed at both Bush and Kerry have obscured these and other issues in the campaign, which is unfortunate. Both men are patriots of high character who have matured and changed since the Vietnam era. Political debate must focus on today's concerns, and in these troubled times, Americans must hold their president to the highest standard of performance. The nation simply can't afford misjudgments like those that led to the Iraq quagmire and deficits so large they prevent the nation from adequately providing for its armed forces, addressing homeland security needs, and guaranteeing the solvency of Medicare and Social Security. The Bush administration has fallen short on foreign policy and fiscal fronts. Now it's time for the citizens of the U.S. to make a change, and they are
absolutely correct.
Sir and ma'am and whoever you are on the editorial board. Nice going. Herald, Sun Sentinel, Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and the Palm Beach Post. Do I have time? Yes.
Good.
It says, go with Kerry's agenda over misplaced priorities. There are many reasons to declare George W. Bush a failed president. We framed the election in terms of why people should vote for John Kerry. Senator Kerry would not rush the country into a war that harms the campaign against terrorism, stretches the military dangerously thin, and diverts attention from real nuclear threats in Iran and North Korea. Instead, he would refocus attention on al-Qaeda and try to reclaim the near worldwide sympathy, goodwill, and cooperation that flowed to this country after 9/11 and which President Bush squandered by invading Iraq. As Senator Kerry has said, the fight against terrorism is more about being resolute. It's about being smart and making the right choices. John Kerry would not allow unfair tax cuts and unchecked spending to swell the deficit, threatening the nation's economy and passing on huge IOUs to younger Americans. Unlike President Bush, whose ideas for tax reform would shift the burden from wealthier Americans to working Americans by taxing wages on consumption more, John Kerry would not allow the tax system to punish the middle class. Tax reform that Mr. Bush proposes would reward those who get stock dividends. An Urban Institute study in 2000 showed that 3.8% of households get 50% of dividends. John Kerry would not favor an energy policy whose centerpiece is drilling in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, which contains at most a six-month supply of oil. He wouldn't allow his vice president to hold secret hearings with energy executives, allow them to write a policy that pleases them but doesn't help the country, then fight in court on the public's tab to keep the public from knowing what happened in those meetings. John Kerry would not support an environmental policy that's named Clear Skies, but actually would be an industry-authored pollution authorization bill. He wouldn't ignore the problem of global warming until just before running for re-election. He wouldn't dismiss science just because it contradicts his policies. He wouldn't compile the worst environmental record of any modern president. Instead, he would protect America's natural resources. He would embrace new job-creating technology that cleans the air and the water. He would realize that self-enforcement of environmental laws is an open invitation to pollute. In Wednesday's third debate, as in the first two, John Kerry looked and sounded presidential, while Mr. Bush looked confused. Mr. Bush has spent so much time before hand-picked audiences that he was puzzled when he threw out campaign applause lines and got silenced back. Senator Kerry displayed more command of issues and showed Americans that he isn't the campaign caricature drawn by the president's political henchmen. Issue by issue, Senator Kerry has laid out a better, fairer, more progressive agenda. He would shore up Social Security, not endanger Americans' retirement, by disguising a risky privatization scheme as part of an ownership society. He would allow embryonic stem cell research, not toward hope by yielding to a narrow ideology. He would offer Americans the promise of health care that's available to members of Congress, not the illusions of tax credits to buy insurance. He would offer laid-off and underemployed Americans training in the assurance that their taxes won't subsidize companies that move jobs abroad. He would appoint Supreme Court justices who leave no political fingerprints on their ruling. Fingerprints on their rulings. You ever see those?
No.
Fingerprints. After 9/11, only princes have them. President Bush had an opportunity to lead the world against a new threat of terrorism. He was eloquent at the National Memorial Service and before Congress. The Democrat-controlled Senate quickly gave him authorization to use force in Iraq, reform airline screening, create a Department of Homeland Security. Already, though, Mr. Bush was allowing a small group in the Pentagon to substitute its agenda for the nation's. Even as planning began for invading Afghanistan, Mr. Bush was looking past al-Qaeda to Saddam Hussein. His administration politicized and delayed airline security improvements over the issue of whether the workers would be unionized. He opposed the Homeland Security Department until May of 2002, when he flipped and supported it as a distraction from testimony by an FBI agent about what the White House knew before 9/11. Then he used the Iraq resolution as political intimidation in the mid-year elections, ramming it through Congress with little debate. Through arrogance and ignorance, the reckless ideologue who called himself a uniter, not a divider, has divided the country against itself and the world against the country. He has bullied, not persuaded. He's made America weaker, not stronger. Desperately seeking re-election, President Bush refuses to acknowledge the reality of Iraq, offering such platitudes as freedom is on the march when the country wants a plan. John Kerry is not in denial about Iraq or any of the other problems Mr. Bush will have left him. Unless the nation is in denial, Senator Kerry will win on November 2nd. Anyone who has failed as badly as Mr. Bush does not deserve another chance. That's the best of them all, Palm Beach Post. Nice going, boys.
Oh.
That's great. How stupid you have to be. How low does your IQ have to be not to see these things?
About 30, man.
If your IQ is 30 or less, I guess you're voting for the Bushmeister, okay? Because you can relate to him. Maybe we ought to send them all to
Abu Ghraib
and have a good time there. Maybe beat some sense into these people. You think?
No.
113 at 560 WQM. Hey, IRS tax problems have a way of ruining all the aspects of your life. They take a toll on you financially, physically, and emotionally, just like working at QAM. You can never really forget about your IRS problems as they come back each morning when you wake up. CPA Jamie Buchwald and the Buchwald Tax Firm will help end your IRS problems forever and give you back peace of mind. That's why other top CPA and law firms refer to their clients to the Buchwald Tax Firm when they have IRS problems. So why not avoid potential criminal prosecution, get all unfiled tax returns prepared, even if you lost all your records? Suppose you have an IRS lien, wage levy, owe payroll taxes and penalties, want to settle for thousands less than you owe. Need time to pay? Whatever it is, the Buchwald Tax Firm can help you out. They offer you a free initial consultation, no obligation, affordable guaranteed fees, immediate relief from IRS harassment. And best of all, you never have to meet with the IRS. The Buchwald Tax Firm handles all the meetings and discussions, so you don't even have to. Call 954-575-2800. That's 954-575-2800. Whether you owe $10,000, a million, or whatever in IRS taxes, the Buchwald Tax Firm can help you. Call 954-575-2800 today for your free consultation, or visit them on the web at irsfreedom.com. That's www.irsfreedom.com, and stop worrying about the IRS knocking at that front door. Call them today, 954-575-2800.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
The Middle Eastern world will be exploded, Saddam had people killed with the gas that we sold him. First time aggressor nation and the only one that's going. Now more blood will be spilled to get that oil flowing. Forget about Korea and the nukes they're toting. And the right wing is drilling it over and over into our heads that Iraq has some weapons of mass destruction. Thousand people killed are now forgotten. Let's exploit them instead. Hey, there's oil to be gotten. Going after Saddam to placate Osama. There's no longer mention of the name Bin Laden, but no one seems concerned. All comfy and complacent, believing every word of this cartel administration that controls us by fear through media manipulation. And the right wing is drilling it over and over into our heads that Iraq has some weapons of mass destruction. The loss of civil rights is the price that we're paying. We're all suspects now, Nazi Ashcroft is saying. I have nothing to hide, table talkers all are saying. Blind, obedient cattle don't have any reservation. About unprovoked battle and world annihilation. Old regimes must fall and Halliburton installed with no objection at all. Democrats don't have the balls and the right wing is drilling it over and over into our brainwashed heads. Iraq has some weapons of mass destruction. Only Iraq has some weapons of mass destruction.
Yeah, we'll find them. Without a doubt, that's the name of that article, Ron Suspan. It's the top article. Nice job there, Eric. It's very lengthy. Take a couple of minutes out. I know you'd much rather see more naked pictures, but we've already got Frederique Van Der Waal, whatever her name is, from Den Haag. Here's a good one for the poll. I love this fax. We got some good faxes today, you know?
Yes, we have.
These people must have gotten a good supply over the weekend.
Where's my share?
During her interviews on 60 Minutes, all Leslie Stahl does is react quizzically by turning her head slightly like a puppy will do when it hears a whistle, thinking that the world believes she's reacting with serious doubt. In all the years I've watched, I've never seen her uncover a story of any kind, except maybe a legal excuse for backhanding a bitch in the face. That is great. Leslie Stahl, let's get her ass on there. Okay, S-T-A-H-L, I better spell it for you, whatever your name is, Josh. See, he kind of dropped down a couple of notches when he spelled swagger with a K and an S.
I can see how people would think that it's swagger on account of...
He didn't spell that right either.
Oh,
and speaking of religious nuts, I love this story, man, so much. I think it was on our website over the weekend, I do believe, and if not, it should have been. Well, I put all these stories on. Even while George was doing his show last week, I was working over a hot word processor.
Right. I got a lot of stuff from that.
Putting all the stories on there. Well, I do good story. I don't always read them so well, but I'm under a lot of stress today, okay? I wasn't at all stressed at about 8:20, and then by 8:25 I was really stressed out. I think that sounds like a lawsuit. Greg, it's a suit! It's a lawsuit, Greg!
An Armani suit.
Yeah. It's better than the one Bush had with that big lump in the back.
The satellite receiver?
Maybe it was a tumor, you think? Anyway, Halloween on Sunday, troublesome Southerners. We're back to that again because we got Halloweeny coming up in about 12 days, 13.
Oh, they ought to change the calendar.
What do you mean by that?
So that they won't be offended because Halloween's on Sunday.
Too bad. Noon in Georgia. Oh, man. There ain't nothing like Georgia. You know, Louisiana, Mississippi, yeah. Alabama. There's something. But I don't think there ain't, and Tennessee, of course. But there ain't nothing like Georgia. Like Conyers, Georgia, and Aintree, and Plains, yeah. All of them places.
Peanuts.
So the fact that the Atlanta Journal-Constitution endorsed John Kerry and ripped Bush an ass in that editorial, that really says something. They're probably hiding under the bed. Now, what's this fax first? It says from Scott, just a few things. What's up with WQM's webpage? Have not been able to get Eddie K's picks for the last two. Like, we know something about QAM's webpage? Oh, my God. Secondly, the Spanish language signal station under your signal is coming from Cuba. Due to skywave propagation, the QM signal is tough to hear at night in Hollywood. Well, that sounds promising. We got a crappy signal. We got Fidel's got an 8-million-watt station cranked up on there. And let's see, and third, in closing, and I'm glad you reminded me of this, Scott. Thank you, Mr. President, for those low gas prices. We forgot to say that today.
Right.
It says, I can't find a gallon of gas for less than $2 anymore anywhere. And he says, thanks for the low gas price. Nice going, Scott. You made a nice comeback there. Now, getting back to noon in Georgia. Across this Bible Belt, this Halloween, some little ghosts and goblins might get shooed away by the neighbors. Shoo, shoo. Remember that Betsy Everett shoo song?
No. The shoop shoop song.
Yeah. No, the shoo shoo song.
All right.
And then it was all shoo Steve also.
Ooh.
And some youngsters will not allow to be going trick-or-treating at all because the holiday this year falls on a Sunday.
Oh, my God.
That's right. It's a day for the good Lord, not for the devil, said Barbara Braswell, who plans to send her 4-year-old granddaughter, Malia, out trick-or-treating in a princess costume on Saturday instead. What kind of a name is that, Malia? Huh?
I don't know.
Oh. Some towns around the country are... And how come her name is Barbara Braswell and her daughter is... I see. That's her
don't
first...
Ask.
That's very common name.
Yeah.
Some towns around the country are decreeing that Halloween be celebrated on Saturday. Well, Saturday is the Jewish Sabbath, baby, until sundown. So, Kasla Hoyce, how do you like that? To avoid complaints from those who might... In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if you do that. The Orthodox Jew is going to open their door, and guess what they're going to do, huh?
It's going to spit on you.
That's for sure. Yeah.
Oy!
That's right. The minute that door opens, baby, a bunch of spittle is going to come your way. Anyway, others insist the holiday should be celebrated October 31st, no matter what. Oh, I think let's have a big conference about this. Let's take it up in Congress. Kind of like gay marriages. I hope that the Democrats are coming up with some good ads, MoveOn.org and the Democratic mm-hmm. Party itself. I sure hope that they really focus in on this thing about the fact that the flu vaccine, we have this tremendous shortage. And they've had since the warnings of 2001 from the CDC that there was going to be a shortage. And in 3 years, they still didn't prepare for it. And the idea that this president is strong on fighting the war on terror, how the hell if we had, God forbid, a chemical or a biological attack, that, of course, is...
Oh, God.
Yeah. Do you really believe that they have any kind of preparation or ability to protect the public or to treat it? Absolutely not.
No. For themselves,
No chance. Oh, for themselves. They got that Archie Bunker there underground, right. You know, where they were all hiding on 9/11.
Right. Lots of Spam and crackers.
Moving Halloween, that's like celebrating Christmas a week early, said Veronica Wright, who bought a Power Rangers costume for her son in Noonan. It's just a kid thing. It's not for real, for Christ's sake. Well, she didn't say that. It's an especially sensitive issue for authorities in the Bible Belt across the South, the Yahoo states. You just don't do it on Sunday, said Sandra Halsey of Greenville, Georgia. That's Christ Day. You don't go to church. You go to church on Sunday. You don't go out and celebrate the devil. So in other words, it's okay to celebrate the devil on Saturday, but not on Sunday, huh?
No, you got it.
Okay. In Noonan, a suburb south of Atlanta, the city council decided to go ahead with the trick-or-treating on Sunday. In 1999, the last time October 31st fell on a Sunday, the city moved up trick-or-treating to Saturday, which brought howls of protest. They were howling like coyotes. We don't need to confuse people with us, Councilman George Alexander be saying. In Vestavia Hills, Alabama, a suburb of Birmingham, a furor erupts every time Halloween falls on Sunday. And local officials decided not to take a stand this time. Let the Fuhrer have his way.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
Bread 'em and say cheese.
Oh,
Well, Buffalo has a football team, the greatest in the land. And everybody thinks they're great, because they really are. The Buffalo Bills are the number one. See what I mean? So just sing along.
When you say Miami,
when you say Buffalo,
Super Bowl,
and you're the Buffalo Bills. Buffalo Bills, they're the greatest team in the history of the human race. They're the Buffalo Bills, they're the greatest thing since sliced bread and canned beer. Yeah, there you go. And you jazz up that redneck stuff. You listen to that banjo. Holy sweet God, listen to that. When you say Buffalo Bills, it don't sound so rednecky, do it? Everybody sing along now. Are you Bill fans? Here we go. Well, the Buffalo Bills are the best team. They have the best record over the last 5 years. And they went to the Super Bowl 4 times, which is more than I can say for this scum-sucking fish. And they're the greatest, because I really like they'll beat the heck out of having a fish on the helmet, because they're the Buffalo Bills, the best football team what I ever seen in the history of my life. They are the Buffalo Bills, the Buffalo Bills, the home of Jim Kelly, the greatest quarterback in the league. Yeah, everybody, the Buffalo Bills. They're the Buffalo Bills. And they've been around longer than the stinking rotten fish. Well, they're the Buffalo Bills. Buffalo Bills. What would you rather have as a pet, a buffalo or a fish?
2702, we got the Mad Dog at 2. What a shame, a great talent gone south, Phil Henry.
Are you sure?
Just gone into the toilet, you know? It happens. A lot of things go into the toilet, most of which we can't discuss here on this show anymore.
Not anymore.
Here's a fact that says, welcome back, and after yesterday's debacle in Buffalo, we need some of the Buffalo Bills fight song. That's why I just played that. See how quick I am? I respond. It says, you think the Dolphins are ever going to win a game? Well,
no.
Not this season.
Not this season. Maybe next season, maybe 25-25 with Zagrin Evans at the quarterback and running
after,
back.
After the Wonstead era.
By the way, it said George did a good job like always. I say George and Suds in the morning and go Yankees. Well, we don't get until you got to that last part about go Yankees. I have to laugh at the Red Sox and their fans, man. What a joke. Do you see that, Josh, after they pulled it out in 12 innings last night? Oh, we won a game. You think they would have just won the World Series, you know? They finally won a game.
On your walk-off home run.
How'd you like to do a walk-off, Bill, doing heavy duty on the Sirius? I don't know. Because if he keeps doing that, I think that from what I'm reading, Infinity is going to, like, chop his ass off of there early.
Mm-hmm.
And then what's your buddy Greg going to do then, huh? Then we're, like, stuck with a dilemma. Well, of course, we always know who's waiting in the bullpen.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
Our good buddy.
Doi.
He's always waiting, hanging around, waiting to... So I'm curious if he's still doing that or what the deal is. Somebody will either fax us or tell us or not, because we don't listen. Oh, this was another great story that I had on the website over the last few days. I don't know if you jumped on this, so to speak. It was on Thursday, so it would have been on Friday's website. Okay. Study, 100%, one in 100 adults asexual.
No, I did not jump on that.
In fact, some of the people I see here in the city, I go, are you sexual, eh? And some of them actually say, okay. About 1% of adults have absolutely, this is from London, of course, which what do you expect from them, huh? Bunch of constipated Brits. Give me the Schmitz. Remember Jimmy Schmitz?
Yes, I do.
About 1% of adults have absolutely no interest in sex, according to a new study, and that distinction is becoming one of pride among many asexuals. Well, how about asexual marriage? What are we going to do with that?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I can just hear Bush now.
The danger to America is...
See, he's already getting all bent out of shape about it. What was that in the background?
The danger to America is the terrorists, and we will not let up in this fight.
The danger is the terrorists. Did you hear that?
I heard it. Nice hum down there.
Anyway, it says the new study was conducted by Anthony Bogert, a psychologist and human sexuality expert at Brock University in St. Catharines, Ontario, eh? See, I knew it. It was published in the latest issue of the Journal of Sex Research and is the focus of a report in this past weekend's issue of New Scientist. Bogert's analyzation looked at responses to another study in Britain published in 1994. That study was based on interviews of 18,000 people about their sexual practices. Practice makes perfect. It offered respondents a list of options. One read, I have never felt sexually attracted to anyone at all. 1% said they agreed with the statement. That response level is close to the percentage of gay people in the population, which is around 3%, the New Scientist report says. Right. Well, where do they come up with this crap? In Britain?
Yeah.
I think they got it twisted around. I think they got 3% in Britain heterosexual. New Scientist says such studies offer insights into sexuality. Their results remain controversial. The closest we've got to understanding human asexuals comes from studies, mostly surveys of people who report not having sex, it says. Like Robert Grieper. A 1994 survey published by the University of Chicago Press found that 13% of 3,500 respondents had no sex in the past year. Well, that doesn't mean that they're asexual. 40% of these people said they were extremely happy or very happy with their lives. If asexuality is indeed a form of sexual orientation, perhaps it won't be long before the issue of A-pride starts attracting more attention. First we had gay pride, now in Canada it's A-pride, eh? Activists have already started campaigning to promote awareness and acceptance of asexuality. Well, I wonder if Mary Cheney would like to become asexual, huh? That dyke.
No, she's happy.
You see, I want to show you how fair and balanced the media is, okay? You had these two things that they made a little bit of a tzimmis about. First of all, Kerry talking about Mary Cheney, using her as an example again about she's a dyke and a lesbian and this and that, and she was born that way, and she's that was the one. Then on the other hand, media is sick. Twisted. They got an agenda, man. That's all we hear about as well. It was really a very poor taste and inappropriate, and two-thirds of the public said they did. How about when Bush lied about having said he doesn't even think about Osama Yamama anymore? He's too busy worrying about Saddam Hussein. Yeah, he's worried about sodomy. Bill O'Reilly's worried about phone sex, and we got a president who's worried about sodomy.
The best way to prevent attacks?
Yeah. He's having panic attacks just thinking about it. Probably thinking about that broad he knocked up in Texas, the one that had the abortion, you know? 20 till 2 at 560 WQAM. Emerald Coast. Here's a chance for Josh to redeem himself, although I doubt it. Emerald Coast, South Florida's best Asian buffet, is excited to announce the arrival of Lobster Fest. That's right. It's going on right now. Every weekend night, come in and enjoy as much Maine lobster as you can eat. That's right. All you can eat lobster. Who else in South Florida would even dream of doing this? Also, Emerald Coast is serving lobster bisque, Jonah Stone crab, roasted duck, and grilled.
See you.
Emerald Coast is no ordinary Asian buffet. The service is impeccable. You never will leave on an empty stomach. I guarantee you that. You'll walk out of there, you'll waddle out. No matter what your size is, you'll waddle out of there. You'll be so full and happy. Start off that fantastic eating experience with 6 different soups. Try them all. And then sample dozens of succulent entrees like New York strip made to order, as well as grilled salmon. And if you have room, sample their hand-carved prime rib and their new Thai specialties, too. The Emerald Coast Buffet promotes healthy living, cooking all of their fine cuisine with only cholesterol-free oils, no crap, no cornstarch, no MSG. The buffet features a full, huge salad bar, full Chinese food lineup, and the brand-new sushi bar as well. And if you have any room after all of these things, which would be a miracle, but try to, like, you know, take your time. They won't kick you out of there. Take some time and save room for dessert, because what a dessert station they've got, featuring Belgian waffles, pies, cakes, pastries, ice cream with all your favorite toppings, even the old fresh fruit. What an ending to a fantastic feast. Emerald Coast got 3 locations for you in Sunrise, Sunny Isles, and Pembroke Pines. So take the whole family and book your next business lunch in there now, too. Takeout delivery always available. They were voted number one by Zagat Restaurant Reviews and by prestigious Channel 7 WSVN News, is South Florida's best Asian buffet. Lots of imitators, but nothing even like it. Call 954-572-3822. That's 954-572-3822 for the Emerald Coast Chinese Buffet.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560-QAM.
It's day oh in Miami Town at 560-WQAM.
I don't know how to name it. We're going to have a little reunion here, Geldy and I. They had a little problem with the Stern Show feed. I think that the satellite fell down or something.
Yeah, like your butt.
Why, I'll have you know my buttocks are delightfully fine. Thank you very much.
Ooh.
Now, if you don't mind, let's return to the sanctity of sports.
How about a little touchy-feely?
Now, see here.
See where?
Over here.
Okay.
Now, see here.
What, your hand?
Ah, what a sucker. You're so stupid.
I ain't so stupid like they say. I'm the official voice of the Panthers.
Big deal. Why, I'll have you know I made my bones when you were an embryo.
How do you know?
Well, it is There's something I never told you.
Yeah?
Well, I'm your father.
Daddy!
Son!
I'm an embryo.
Get your thumb out of there.
146, 14 till 2 at 560 WQM. Our poll question today, what well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? Had a lot on the list. I guess if I had to take more calls, we could add thousands, but this is a pretty good list.
I like it.
Rush Limbaugh leading, look at the landslide, man, 283.
Oh, yeah. Ain't no
catching
him. Yeah. He's the fastest fat man.
Bill O'Reilly, 78. He's moving on up. Jimmy Swaggart, 48. Kathy Lee Gifford, 46. Dr. Phil, 39. You know who we left off the list?
I give up.
I got a pair.
Pavel Bure.
You can't see him. I got a pair. Anyway, Jerry Falwell, Pat Robertson.
Oh, yeah.
Sneering, obnoxious, phony baloney. I'll give you another one.
Okay.
Paul Crouch.
Ooh, yeah.
From Jan and Paul Crouch.
Sure. Oh, yeah.
Paul Crouch, you got it?
Remember that thing, that article?
That thing?
Yeah.
There was a thing. That's what he said. Speaking of things, Sinclair Broadcasting, a bunch of Nazis who own 62 television stations around America. The Kerry campaign on Friday called on Sinclair Broadcasting to provide equal time to supporters of the Democratic presidential nominee after they aired that 45-minute propaganda film attacking him. In a letter to Sinclair Broadcasting, President David Smith, Kerry campaign attorney Mark Elias said the broadcasting group's demand that its 62 stations air the program without insisting they provide equal airtime for response is illegal, which, of course, it is. Please consider this a request. It would be like if CBS announced that they were going to have all of their affiliates, they were going to order them to run Fahrenheit 9/11 like 2 weeks from today, the day before the election, which, by the way, not a bad idea. Please consider this a request that each Sinclair station that airs the documentary provide supporters of the Kerry Edwards campaign with a similar amount of time on that station before the election at a time where an audience of similar size can be expected to be viewing the station, Elias wrote. With less than 3 weeks to go in an extremely close presidential race, sparks are flying around the anti-Kerry film, Stolen Honor, Wounds That Never Heal, which Sinclair wants to air commercial-free, no less, on stations that include the swing states of Ohio, Florida, Iowa, and Wisconsin next week. The FCC, where, of course, the chairman is the son of Colin Powell, Michael Powell and the FCC, said they won't intervene to stop the broadcast, as was asked to do in a letter from 18 Democratic senators. Don't look to us to block the airing of a program, FCC Chairman Michael Powell said. I don't know of any precedent in which the commission could do that, he'd be saying. Sinclair Broadcasting's top executives are public supporters of the Bush campaign. They've donated at least $58,000 to the Bush-Cheney campaign or the Republican National Committee for this election. And a partridge in a pear tree. How do you like that?
I don't.
That's more of that liberal media that we're always hearing about.
Right.
Iraq audit can't find billions.
Again?
About half of the roughly $5 billion in Iraq reconstruction funds disbursed by the U.S. government in the first half of this year can't be accounted for, according to an audit commission by the United Nations, which couldn't find records for numerous rebuilding projects and other payments. Maybe we ought to go to the Halliburton people and see where some of them went. One chunk of the money, $1.4 billion, was deposited into a local bank by Kurdish leaders in northern Iraq, but could be tracked no further. The auditors reported that they were shown a deposit slip, but could find no additional records to explain how the money was used or to prove that it remains in the bank. Auditors also said they couldn't track more than $1 billion in funds doled out by U.S. authorities for hundreds of large and small reconstruction projects. This is an article we had over the weekend from the Boston Globe. It's on our website. It goes on and on and on, and it's pathetic. It's sad. It's tragic. And does anybody care?
No.
And as if that isn't good enough. Not that we want to get you, like, all suspicious of your government, because we do trust the president, don't we?
Right, yeah.
Right. As far as we can throw him. Top Army commander in Iraq complained of poor supply situation, document shows from yesterday's Washington Post. This is about your friend Rick Sanchez.
I know, the other one.
Not the one we saw on CNN this morning, with his fist on the table. I never realized he had a limp fist. The top U.S. commander in Iraq complained to the Pentagon last winter that his supply situation was so poor, and you're supposed to say,
How poor was it?
I love that show. I love Match Game. That it threatened Army troops' ability to fight, according to an official document that surfaced only now. The lack of key spare parts for gear vital to combat operations, such as tanks and helicopters, was causing problems so severe that Army Lieutenant General Ricky Tiki Ricardo S. Sanchez wrote in a letter to top Army officials, that I can notice how the media just slept right on by that. And now here's their other henchman, Ricky Tiki Sanchez, who says he can't continue to support sustained combat operations with rates this low. Senior Army officials said that most of Sanchez's concerns have been addressed in recent months, but they continue to keep a close eye on the problems he identified. The situation is substantially better now, he said Gary Motzek, Deputy Director of Operations for Army Materiel Command. Sanchez, who was the senior commander on the ground in Iraq from the summer of 2003 till the summer of 2004, said in his letter that Army units in Iraq were struggling just to maintain relatively low readiness rates on key combat systems such as M1 Abrams tanks, Bradley fighting vehicles, anti-mortar radars, and Black Hawk helicopters. He also said units were waiting an average of 40 days for critical spare parts, which he noticed was almost three times the Army's average. In some Army supply depots in Iraq, 40% of critical parts were at zero balance, meaning they were absent from depot shelves. And by the way, I should point out to you, since everything is going so great in Iraq.
Oh, we're fine.
On some of the shows, some of the correspondents that have been reporting from Iraq are saying that they're terrified to even go outside anymore. The situation is so bad now in most parts of Iraq. So it sounds like we got things well under control.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560.
Push. Your vote's automatically calculated by computers at the GOP. Manipulated this time. Don't let the fascist neocons screw us again. The brother governor that's running Florida, no doubt's got another plan to get your vote. Then those triangle Bush twins, you're the blue and Coulter snub. Oh, my loins with thought of
rear.
The Jews killed Christ. The Jews killed Christ. Bush is appointed by God. Rigged for Bush to win in a landslide this time. Don't let the fascist neocons screw us again. Some will let us in, the suspectors in, clean white face.
Computer problems at 9 of 14 voting sites in South Florida already this morning. Nice going, good start.
Yeah.
Oh, this is just the beginning, man. You think it was exciting before, and they keep showing on the talking head networks. They keep showing the Palm Beach judge, you know, with the eye looking through the shade.
Yeah.
Oh, Google Eye judge. I love him. He the best. Anyway, our poll today, what well-known person do you think is the biggest phony? A lot of phonies. We got about 700 votes. Rush Limbaugh. Nobody can touch Rush. Big, fat, pill-popping, hypocrite phony. 297. His numbers, by the way, have taken a pretty good slide.
Good.
Bill O'Reilly's radio numbers can't slide in South Florida because he don't have any. He's got a .2, as in what's the point. He's got 83 votes. Jimmy Swagger at 50. I'm amazed. He deservedly so, but that's good. They got a good memory. Kathy Lee Gifford, 47. Dr. Phil, I told you he'd run. Boy, they hate him like poison, and I'm pleased to hear that. 45. The Pope, 26. Altar Boys. Condoleezza, 25. That's Dr. Rice. Miss Matt Drudge, 16. Dennis Miller, 14. Ann Coulter, 14. Phil Henry, 12.
Are you sure?
Yep. J-Lo's got 11, and Lynn Cheney, 11. Everybody else, small potatoes, single digits. That's Lynn Cheney, by the way, the one that's got the bulldog daughter.
Bye, bye, bye!
Our Scott Show, Neil Rogers, and sports around the clock. WQAM, Miami, Fort Lauderdale.
May I see your Annie?
I don't think so.